It is March 12, 2012. My name is Crystal Clark. And before we get started, I would like to thank Helvetic, the creator of the information-machine.blogspot.com, for asking me to host this presentation with James Horak. If you're not familiar with James Horak's work, you can find it at his blog, which is www.emvsinfo.blogspot.com. And he's also done several interviews that you can find. I highly recommend it, especially if you're not familiar with any of it. He covers a great deal of information. And today we're going to try to pull some of it together in a way that I hope people will find meaningful. And we also have on the line with us another friend of ours, and he does the audio-visual presentations that go along with these talks. So thank you, James, very much also for being here with us and helping us get your information out.
Thank you, Crystal.
One of the things that I really appreciate about you, James, because it is very rare, is that you appreciate that some things really are just so wondrous and beautiful and extraordinary that they don't need to be embellished or exaggerated or upsold. They just are. And I think that with all of these images coming out, showing these craft on and around the sun, that this is a really good example of that. So why don't we start there? What are they? What are they doing? And why are we seeing so many of them now?
The vast majority of these objects that we see are EMVs, electromagnetic vehicles, which were named by Dr. Berggren in his work, The Ringmakers of Saturn. He could derive that they were task-driven as they operated in the rings of Saturn.
And just so people know, you can still get that book. It's wonderful. There are beautiful images. It's color. I was fortunate enough to get it before we started this conversation, so I had a chance to look through it. And it really is amazing. I highly recommend it, especially to astronomers.
Well, yes, and I think most astronomers are very much aware of what's in that book because they can see it. But they're not allowed to discuss it because they're under the same restraints that many people are in that are on the inside of government programs. They have to submit every discovery and every nuance of information that isn't commonplace to the Office of Astronomical Telegrams for review. And the Office of Astronomical Telegrams tells them whether or not they can go public with it. So it's constraints like that that limit the information and keep these people that would have evidence, the best evidence, from being able to bring it into the public forum.
That's very, very true. And just so people know, the name of his book is called The Ringmakers of Saturn, and his name is Norman R. Berggren. And even though there's quite a bit of hubbub about the images that we've been seeing for the last couple of years, especially in these satellite images, this book was actually produced in 1986. So it's not necessarily a new phenomenon, but it's getting a lot more attention. Can you tell us why we're seeing so many of these now?
It's not that this is anything new. They differ in the amount that you will see at any one time in the sun, depending upon what they're doing and what is the state of the sun at the time. But they've always been there, and they are necessary. They're an ingredient of nature that is essential to maintain the stability, the equilibrium that must exist between planets in a system such as ours that entertains a fusion star-sun.
And that's the really important thing, I think, that people need to look at in a great deal of depth, because what you're saying is that a solar system like ours that supports sentient life cannot exist without these critters that we call EMVs. Is that right?
Absolutely. And that's not all of what they do. They are essential to the beginning of a system, making it friendly and ready for hosting complex life. They do it in a number of ways. And then when it's in trouble, they are also present to help stabilize its crust, which they have an operation here in Utah, which helps do that. Without it, we'd be in a really bad shape right now if we existed at all. The EMVs have multiple tasks, and they are adequate to them in any case, and their number, size, and shape even, to some extent, is modifiable.
To suit the task.
Yes, always, always. It's a form of beauty, if you think about it.
It's very beautiful, and I know that it's kind of a far-out thing, but I think people are getting to the point where they realize that humanity has really been stuck in kind of a bubble, like the Earth bubble. And it reminds me of an ant stuck in a droplet of water. He knows what's going on inside of the water, but when he tries to look out, it's very distorted. And of course, we know that a great deal of information has been hidden on purpose to help provide that distortion. So it's very helpful, I think, to find someone like you who can give us a much, much broader view beyond the bubble, because they are connected. And I think that's important. So one of the things that Norman Berggren wrote about in his book is that these things are not just helping to maintain a kind of equilibrium in the solar system, but they're actually creating parts of it. And he noticed that with the rings of Saturn. So can you explain to us why they work within the rings of Saturn and what they're doing?
Well, now, what I'm going to explain is not something that Norman Berggren would be ready to get into quite the same way. I've talked with him about it, and that's when he asked a leading question, which soon ended our relationship. Understandably, and I hated to be put in that situation because I don't see that he had any other choice. But what the rings are about, and Saturn isn't the only planet in this system that has elements of this. The rings are made up of matter that is taken from other planets. It's put in the rarefied atmosphere that is outside, is still in the gravitational pull of the planet, but is outside its atmosphere, so that this matter is not shielded from cosmic bombardment. The cosmic bombardment reduces it to where the mineral compounds inside become more and more efficacious to tissue, to cell life. When this process is completed, the material will be returned to the planet from whence it was taken, and that is the essential nutrient support for life. Without it, there is no life on a planet.
And this is true not just of our system, but this is the general model for other solar systems. Is that
yes.
right? Okay.
Throughout the universe.
Okay, now this is really beautiful and wondrous from the perspective that I've heard you say that even members in the extended community, who we would just view as kind of outside the bubble, view them as the hand of God.
One of the frailties of modern science in this world today is that there is a trend the further and further you get into cosmology, there's a false sense of refinement and excluding design or something that might resemble in people's mind God. To the notion that a highly advanced culture, far more advanced than that on Earth, could entertain notions of design, and hence God, would come as quite a shock to these people that have worked so hard to eliminate God and design as an equation to any cosmology on Earth.
That's very true, and it's really kind of sad because it's really such a simple thing to make the connection between the fact that if there's a design, there's a designer. And that's far more beautiful a story, I think, than a lot of people settle for through solely science. Let me ask you, James, why do they use the rings of Saturn and not another planet?
Well, basically, because that's the single best purpose, to wit, to put Saturn II, due to its more central location to the planetary array, and also it has yet to be introduced to settlement or to groups of expeditions there. In other words, it's not inhabited like some of the other
right.
planets and planet moons.
Right. So basically, that is just Saturn's purpose at this moment in our design.
For the most part, yes. Yes, that's okay. A central purpose. Yeah.
Okay. I know that there's a question that every person on this planet has. It's a natural question. It's a burning question. And James is really the first person I've ever come across who can answer it, and not just in some kind of topical way, but the answer also explains so many of the other anomalies that we have in our solar system. So the burning question that every human being has, and it's really a two-part question, but not really, is who we are and where we came from. And it's becoming more and more obvious that the farther back in time we go, the more advanced we were at some point. And the insight that you have into this answers so many questions, and I think it will really help people dial in on what's so important about your information. So let's begin by talking about, where did humans come from?
Humans came from a system that is quite a distance from ours today. They are the remnants of a very proud culture, civilization that actually inhabited more than one planet. They had reached an elegant level of technology where they were beginning to affect their star. They had a binary system, and one star had precedence over the other. And that star, they were trying to develop in ways that other cultures had, in a representation of a anvil or a method of travel to other star systems that was efficient. Due to some gross inaccuracies that were made, the system became destabilized at a time that an expedition was headed for a more remote area of this part of the galaxy, where they wanted to build settlements for colonization. Fortunately, they had obtained a mass in the way of what we now call a moon in order to take the provisions, the minerals, everything that they would need to be absolutely self-sufficient. It was probably an afterthought at the time to achieve this self-sufficiency that they had already begun to detect the system was becoming unstabilized. While they were in transit, they lost completely their system. And they came into this system shortly afterwards and began looking for the best prospect of a planet to reestablish themselves. That planet was Mars. And having a fondness for their planet, or a fondness for some meadow of their system, they put their vehicle, which was the moon, in orbit around Mars, which brought Mars back to a life it seemed to have lost, and worked fine for 50,000 years.
All right, James, before we go on, I want to make sure that people really understand what you've just said. Our ancestors came from another system, and there were two things going on simultaneously. At one point, they had decided that they wanted to move out into the universe and colonize a new section. At the same time, they had people that were, it's that same story, we see it all the time, that were messing with things that they didn't understand in their own system, and they made an error that caused the destruction of their own system. So these two things were going on simultaneously, right?
Yes. Okay. Very sad.
It is very, very sad. But it's also lucky that these were going on at the same time, because that our ancestors would have went extinct at that point if they had not already had these provisions in place. Now, the moon is fairly large, and what you've explained is that they prepared the moon as a vehicle in which a large segment of their population could travel to this new destination that they had chosen. But what I've gleaned from other interviews that you've done is that this was not their intended destination, and that something happened when that system destructed that maybe put them a little off course. Is that fair to say?
Yes. They had reasons for not trying to travel any deeper in their original destination because they knew they could not receive any reinforcements from their former system. So it gave rise to a sense of desperation. And they could get to this outpost system, which is our solar system today, with more ease. And knowing the structure of this system put more faith in the ability to be able to settle here with the help of some people that were already here, that were highly advanced and had indicated that they would help them.
Okay, so when they ended up here in our system, the Earth had not been prepared properly to host what we refer to as sentient life. It wasn't inhabited or colonized yet in that sense. Is that why Mars became the logical stopping point?
Yes. The Earth was being hit by debris from the asteroid belt at much greater incidence than it had been and has been since. And the people that lived underneath the crust of Mars had found a way to protect Mars. And some of the other planets that were inhabited, the Earth was considered almost hostile. A lot more vulcanization going on at the time. And, you know, it didn't help to get hit by an asteroid every once in a while that made that even worse. So Mars wasn't much different at that time than it is now, so placing the moon in orbit around it revitalized it, and the mantle started to grow again. And this is vital to make a planet vibrant and to hold the respirant that these people needed. So it began to develop to have rains that it hadn't had for a long time. The poles enlarged, canals were dug. And those canals were even visible up until the mid-30s from Earth.
Now, what you've just said is really important, because a lot of what we're doing here is not just establishing our human lineage, but also a new cosmology in terms of design. So what you've just said is that a moon is required as well for this type of abundance. And the moon is a spaceship, is what you're saying, but it was created in a way that gave them everything that they needed to make a very, very long journey. Because if I remember in another show, you said that they didn't originally plan to come here. They had planned to go somewhere else, but even that journey was going to take something like 300 years. So when we say that they made necessary preparations for this journey, we're talking about a lot of preparation.
Yes. Something similar is going on in the asteroid belt now in creating a body similar to the moon in the same way that the moon was created by your ancestors. And it's organizing of matter of the debris in the asteroid belt for two reasons. Mainly if such a vehicle is needed, and to collect a lot of the problematic material that is in these meteor swarms and in these asteroids that are coming in. And to protect planets, especially their moons.
Mm-hmm. And that's another really neat part of the story, is that you have collectives kind of working together to ensure the health of a system. And so we do have other members of the extended community working to do this. We have the EMVs working to do this. And it's really a very, very neat story. In terms of the moon, you mentioned that I want to make sure that people make the connection between the moon and helium as a respirant, because that also has a lot to do with what you refer to as split consciousness. Other people may know it as the left brain and the right brain kind of not communicating. So I want to talk about that, because the moon isn't just about the water. So help us understand why helium is so important.
Originally, the respirant in the system that your ancestors indulged for so long was a mixture of the same gases that you have here, but oxygen in a lesser degree, and helium, which you don't have in your atmosphere and isn't part of your respirant gas. Helium is more efficient as a respirant, and indeed it can be buffered much more easily. In some cases, doesn't even need to be buffered to be reused. But when it's used in combination with other gases, there is less oxidation reduction. You live longer. In some cases, some individuals might even have their life expectancy doubled, because oxidation reduction is aging. And that's the prime reason that you age much faster than did your ancestors. The Earth today, and the Moon to some extent, cannot hold helium to it because it has an inconstant gravity wave. And that is caused because that machines have to be in place to maintain the slave orbit that the moon observes with Earth. Because it's too large, it's got an inconstant mass, has a vast cavity inside it, and it wants to either go out or come in. And there are machines that are set in the moon and on Earth to keep it in parity. Now, if they weren't there, we'd either lose the moon or it'd come into Earth.
All right, so let me ask you this. Is it normal for planets that host sentient life like ours to have helium as a respirant?
Yes.
Okay. And if that's the case, then the moon would also be a necessary function to create a gravity wave that allows helium to be held to the planet in the atmosphere. Is that right?
Well, if it were correct for the planet, yes, and it would. But,
in our situation, if we go back to the beginning of the story, this all just kind of happened. It wasn't really planned. So our ancestors got off track. They came here. They met another race who was very, very advanced and tried to help them kind of engineer a little bit of our system to help them find a home. Would that be a fair way to say it?
Oh, yes.
Okay. All right, so in trying to do that, this race helped them build these machines that would kind of self-balance the moon so that it wouldn't keep coming in and out. But there was a problem. Can you explain that to us?
Well, basically the problem was that before these machines were adjusted completely, the inconstant gravity wave corrected. These people that had helped man left. They aspired to a spiritual technology that involves an incorporation of the mind and soul into spirit, but as a collective, an entire culture, civilization doing this, every individual at once. A very rare thing, but that's what happened. And, of course, they knew that they had left your ancestors with the ability to compensate and to figure it all out. But what they hadn't counted on is that, in the meantime, a caste system had arrived as a sort of priesthood. And they were more elitist. And they began to see that they could enslave. Of course, this is an increment. This comes about over a period of 25,000 years that they could utilize it. They just gave them a selective advantage, knowing what it was that could split the consciousness and render people more servile to a class that knew how to utilize this.
Let's talk about that for a minute, because helium is involved in this. So our ancestors, where they, in the system that they came from, had helium in their atmosphere, is that right?
Yes.
Okay, so they had unified consciousness. It was when they came here and began to, over generations, live in an environment that did not have that, that the split consciousness began to develop. And I think that's important because that tells us that helium has some very special properties. It means that helium is not just a gas, it's almost like a field unto itself, isn't it?
Well, first of all, helium isn't an element. It's a condition of matter. I like to compare it with the binary system, where your elements are ones, and helium is its placekeeper, zero. It is a condition of the other matter. It's difficult to explain, but the ancients had an inkling when they called it the ether.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the most plentiful element in the universe because suns produce it. The only way that it's derived on Earth is a certain amount is given off as a byproduct from refining oil into gasoline. And you have to know how to catch it and to contain it, because it wants to go into outer space immediately. So you collect it, condense it, and produce liquid if you want. You can produce liquid helium, which is the preferable way to ship it. But helium is very interesting in aspect, and if its value wasn't minimalized by the way that it is cataloged and classified, And it was open to a more broadened interpretation as to how many ways it's useful. Then it's like opening up a box of opportunity that you kept the lid on all these hundreds of years. But helium is more a symptom of an astronomical problem than it is anything else, though. It indicates that there is a inconstant gravity wave that is detrimental and that could be fixed if the elite had not discovered that it was opportunistic to not just to leave the situation as it is, but to create it even worse.
Let's talk about why that was even possible for them to do. Is helium, again, if we look at it like a field per se, is it that because we no longer had direct access to an information field outside of ourselves? And when you don't have a connection to the source, we could say, then people can tell you anything they want and manipulate you because you don't really know. Is that a fair way to explain it?
Well, there's a power in knowing. And this is one of the things that I offend so many people with, is that I come off as somebody that just knows everything. Well, I don't know everything. I come off as somebody that just is speculating but asserting it as fact. Well, I do make leaps, but my leaps are very well directioned, and I always base them on something that is concrete. But of course, some of the things that I say may seem that I'm expecting you to take on too much faith, but then again, bear in mind this. It's one world when your scientists and men of letters build a construct, a cosmology, and then can't resolve the vast number of anomaly that keep popping up to refute it. It's one thing just to ignore it and to label it with their invented word, anomaly, stick it up on a shelf, just forget it. It's anomaly.
Of course, the problem with that is that the anomalies, until they are solved, are telling us that we don't have the formula right.
That's right. The anomaly are the clue to the next step up, the next revelation, the next level that may take us to the stars.
Back to the stars, yes.
Back to the stars, yes. Yes, indeed.
And that's important, too. So we've covered a lot of really important things here, and I want to be sure that people get these connections, because there are so many of us who have never bought the Anunnaki, we were created to be a slave race garbage, really. But without being able to have a view from outside of that bubble, we just bounce around inside of it. So I think it's really important. Everybody has always wondered, where did we come from? And it really does answer so many questions once we have that. Now, the way that humanity has been exploited so terribly is not new to our time. It's been going on since the arrival of our ancestors here, in the sense that it was noticeable that it could be done in the beginning, and then we had groups that took advantage of that. And now here we are in 2012, recognizing, I think, collectively, for the first time, that we have been severely dumbed down on purpose. It started a very long time ago. We see it in the way where our education system works. I mean, all of it. We all know that, so we don't really have to go into that. So let's talk about how the Earth was designed. And something I want to point out to people, there are nuances in the way you speak that lend a great deal of authenticity to what you're saying, because people trapped inside of the bubble, it's the box we're stuck in. And if we don't have any view beyond that, we can't pull anything outside of it in. And our limitations are reflected back to us in the terms that we use. And there are many. I'm only going to point out one. But one of the things that I found instantly really fascinating about you is that you have talked very specifically about two different races, and you named them. Now, that may seem inconsequential, but you'll notice throughout our entire history on this planet, from the view inside of the bubble, that any time a human being says they've had some kind of a communication with another race, they always name the race after their planet, right? We have the Palladians, and we have the Andromedans and the Martians, but they actually have names. And if we really had deep, meaningful relationships with these races, we would know that. So this particular race that helped out our ancestors, you've referred to them before as the Druge.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
And that is an astute observation you just made.
There are many, but I don't want to give them all away because self-discovery is important. And I'll just leave it there. But now I'm sure that the next question on everybody's mind would be, what was the name of our ancestors?
That is very interesting because it does carry over into your present. What I would say is that the word conforms to your word man. And what it basically infers is a context of self-identity. These were people that, very much like the people on Earth, that hold to the land and that love their environment, that are creative with it. This is in total opposition to those who adopt this exploitation. You have two types of people on the earth today. You have the exploiter, materialist, and you have the spiritual individual who is looking constantly for something better. And these two don't mix. And you see couples where a woman is of one type and the man is of another that get along. But they get along basically because neither ideal is realized. It's almost in balance by not being formative. If you put these two together and obtained a balance between the creative and the materially objective, and you didn't seek to vilify either one, the blend would be what you would have in the name man. That's how it came about. This is a conflict that was resolved by your ancestors half a million years ago.
That's extraordinary. And of course, what you're saying also is another mirror of split consciousness. How the individual, and of course, many, many people have talked about this in their own research, myself included. Women have a tendency to use or rely on one hemisphere of the brain and men the other. Now, it's not always men and women, of course. You have exceptions. You have women that are incredibly left-brained and, you know, numbers and facts and figures, and you have men that are wonderful artists. But what we have lost is that blend in a single human being, which is what you refer to as unified consciousness.
Yes, and that's a little bit rough way to put it, but it's elegantly true. It's elegantly true in the sense that basically that's the pattern that everything conforms to on this planet. The exceptions that I have seen are people that have suffered brain damage. The brain goes to reconstruct anew itself, and this time it has some wisdom it didn't have when it was 4, 5, 6, 7 years old. And it goes back and reforms itself without the junk and unifies. And I've seen this in people. There are examples of it, but quite often these people have a portion of their brain that's just virtually useless and somehow compensate for it and then exceed and then just become geniuses, become capable of things that are just unimaginable. Develop sensory perceptions that are not normal, but that excel. This happens, and basically it reveals just how stunting the imprinting is that is applied to children when you try to teach them to conform at too early an age.
Which, again, is the exploitation of the split consciousness.
It is the rule of thumb that the elite have employed, wittingly or unwittingly, or wittingly and unwittingly, over thousands of years, basically over hundreds of thousands of years. And what keeps you recycling back to a lesser being that's less capable of dealing with problems that incorporate everyone? It's no problem to be class conscious and get things done efficiently. But when you're dealing with other classes that you regard in a different way, or races, or even species, because there have been different species living concurrently, even in this lineage, on this planet, until one institution decided to get rid of them.
Right, and I want to clarify something about helium because I don't want people to get the impression that if you go to a party store and get helium balloons and you inhale the helium, you're suddenly going to have an epiphany because that's
No.
not what we're talking about. So the helium itself would be combined with other things, and that would be a proper respirant.
Yes, that would be a proper respirant. If you had to, you could subsist on helium, but that's not recommended because it would be like trying to get your sea legs on a ship in a gale. Simply wouldn't do it.
Okay, now let's go back to now that we've covered how split consciousness came to be in our more modern version of our human ancestry, which it was not normal in our ancestors. We've covered how it came to be and how it's been exploited. So let's look at that a little bit more because when the Druze helped our ancestors try to tame the earth to become a suitable home, the moon was used because we've already covered that the moon is essential in creating this kind of a combination. And there were machines in the moon, as well as machines placed here on the earth. And they worked together, but we didn't quite cover what happened and why the final adjustments weren't made and why we still have the problem of an inconsistent gravity wave and why the earth doesn't hold helium. So let's cover that.
Sometimes, as things progress, civilizations and cultures think in terms of bigger is better, more population, more expansion, and so forth. And this was raising its ugly head among your ancestors right after the first 10,000 years you were on Mars. And the idea that was conceived to tap the mantle was ill-advised.
The mantle of
And
Mars.
the mantle of Mars, because it was too thin, it was too young, it was too thin. What was intended was to relate Mars with the Sun in a more dynamic way. And this can be done by energy frequency shift. But you have to have a way of setting the harmonics of your mantle. It's kind of like getting the electrical phase correct in an armature. So they started to do this, and of course, the Druze had advised strongly against this, but they did it anyway. And so this began to affect the Martian stability, the ability to hold its atmosphere, everything, because you had two dynamics in play. You had the ability of the Martian atmosphere and its layers to hold in the atmosphere and the protection that a magnetosphere, ionosphere, all of these things have with respect to cosmic radiation, cosmic bombardment, and this changed everything. It wasn't expected because the formulations that they had brought with them from the original system that man had was a binary system, and things operated differently.
Let's define that before we move on, James, because there are a lot of people insisting that our solar system is a binary system, but that's not the case. Can you please define what a binary system is?
A binary system is a system with two stars or two suns, and we have a single sun, so we do not have a binary system.
All right, so our ancestors came from a system that was binary, and they were trying to apply the laws they understood of that system to this system. And that caused some problems.
Yes. They couldn't do this on the basis of two reference points that the binary system allowed them. And so when they tried to do what they did, as they had done it in their own original system, worse came to worse. So Mars began in a rapid decline. And it would have been seen as gradual in some respect because Mars didn't become the dead planet that it is now for 25,000 years from the time that that catastrophic mistake was made. But it did mean that water, rains, the weather would begin ending very quickly. And these are essential.
Okay, so it sounds like maybe our ancestors were trying to make more of a home out of Mars, but then they made this error. It's interesting for people listening who do a lot of research on different topics. You'll find that a lot of things that James discusses cross over into so many different areas, whether it's religion, whether it's past life testimony, just all kinds of different things. You'll find that his information is lending a great deal of clarity to the information that we have. And I'll give you an example. I've come across past life testimonies where the individual specifically said that what caused the destruction of Mars was that they were playing with the atmosphere. But in fact, what you're saying is the atmospheric conditions were really the byproduct of another error that was made with the mantle.
Yes, yes. I don't think that even at the high level of technology that your ancestors had, both before they came to this system and for 50,000 years afterwards, I don't think that they really appreciated the complexity of what they were trying to do, because it had never been done in their history. They
underestimated. Well, they did do it once, and it went very badly.
Well, what they were trying to do on Mars had succeeded in their own system. It was only when they went to the next level that they created something so catastrophic. But, of course, at that time, there was not an extended community that exists today in their world. By world, I mean their experience. So if such a thing wouldn't happen today, because they're almost anywhere you would go, ET has formed extended communities. In every extended community, there are people that are so far ahead of you that they can apprehend what's going to happen when you do something like that, step in and say, no, you don't want to do that, and give you the benefit of a far vaster frame of reference. You know, if you stop and think about it, and it's what I call the principle of inevitability. If you imagine that there are these people, because over a period of time, the variation and the way in which intelligent life seeks out new places and new experiences, not necessarily exploiting as in colonization, but to find new knowledge, to find what's out there. It's exploring for discovery. Not for opportunizing resources and things like that, because it's only when you don't regulate your population that you exceed your resources, that you commercialize values instead of maintain the humanist values that actually secure happiness, that people can understand the exploration for discovery and not exploitation. That there's a marked difference. We can't see that here. Oh, they got to be there because they want something we have, or they want to make us a meal, or they want to, No. When you reach a certain level of technology where you can travel to the stars, and this is invariable, if you maintain the savagery of that kind of thinking, you're not going to survive to the next step. You're going to eliminate yourself, because one person will end up possessing the ability to destroy his own planet, hold it in their hand. So what's going to happen? If you haven't obtained the cultural distinctions and differences at both the level of thought and the level of procreation, you'll destroy yourself. It's an invariable. It's a sad truth. Most people that even near that level of star travel do it before they get there.
And I would say that the exploitation of split consciousness makes it happen even faster, because when you develop a caste system, that begins to split the population. And we see that now, you know, the rich, the 1% and the 99%. And then information is denied to certain parts of the population. And really educated people, properly educated people with real knowledge, not what passes for an education now, are full of wonder and opportunity and will often have fewer children because they have something else to do that's more fun. You know, if you look at a small town where there's no industry, the children don't see any other future but we get married and we sit down and we have children and that's our life. And when split consciousness is exploited to the degree that it is, you have a very large segment of the population really locked into existing and surviving instead of really living. And of course, that holds back the entire culture, not just the people that are deprived. I just want to make sure that people know that when we talk about population management, we are in no way condoning genocide.
Of course. I mean, people that are already here have every right to remain here, to have a life, and to achieve the social stability and the means, as anyone else, to hog resources, to have such a disproportionate distribution of wealth, to allow monopolies and to allow people to prey on each other the way they do here. This is savagery. It's savagery. And what we are right now are savages with dangerous toys.
Very dangerous toys.
Very dangerous. But of course, the mechanisms are in place to keep us from endangering others outside this realm of influence.
They should be in place. I think anybody would agree with that.
Well, you'd be surprised how many people have said, we understand that what nature is. We understand that when it gets this bad, where nobody will want to live on this planet. We understand what has to be done. We understand that.
And we are not there yet, but we are clearly on that path and accelerating.
Yes, sadly. Sadly. Mm-hmm. And you have friends. You have many wonderful ET civilizations looking in on this right now. They have to wait on you in many ways. They've given you extra time. You would have already had World War III twice if it hadn't been for their involvement.
And involvement is, it's limited. They're obviously not going to come here and fix anything for us, and nor should they.
Well, everything at this level, up to the point where you graduate into overcoming your technology, and that's the secret, where you put everything where it should be. When you say hydrogen bombs, no. Atomic bombs, no. All this money for weapons, you know, I really am overwhelmed. The people that go around talking about weapons of mass destruction being the ones that have the most weapons of mass destruction. You don't hear people in the Congo or people in New Guinea or people at the tip of South America talking about weapons of mass destruction. You hear the United States and Israel and China and Russia talking about it, and they've got them all, just about.
Yes, it's a very, very lopsided view, that's for sure.
It's just ridiculous, and they want more. And they've got all these probes running to get more. The thing, and I've talked about this before, that keeps them from coming to balance with themselves is, oh, we got to get this before somebody else gets it. We got to be the first to get it and all that. You know, that kind of thinking, look where it's led you.
And that's always been the problem, is that we advance technologically before we advance spiritually, and we get stuck on this loop, and we do it over and over and over. And that's the loop that we're trying to get out of. And I think that if people could recognize, especially that so many of the technologies and tools that they're using to garner more power and consolidate it, to carry out genocide, are actually destroying the what we need for life to exist. So they're turning nature in on itself, believing that they can somehow survive that. And I want to talk about that because there's this wonderful myth out there that they can go hide while the rest of us get killed off, and this is not going to be allowed. And I want to talk about that because there are a lot of people that would be happy to know that. So we've established that our ancestors did have a relationship with this race on Mars known as the Druge. The Druge tried to help them establish themselves. And so when we hear people say, well, there are bases on Mars, let's talk about that, because this planet was inhabited long before we got there. So when we're talking about bases, what are we really talking about? Is there a single base that humans have actually built on that planet, or have they just kind of maybe shuffled into them?
They had visions of building colonies on Mars and on the moon both. And they started some ambitious beginnings, but when they began to weaponize, when they began to build defenses, then they were welcomed off.
And to be clear, we're talking about modern humans right now. We're not talking about our animals.
We're talking about what has happened in the last 40 years.
So that's really encouraging, I think, because they're not going to be able to hide. We hear people say that all the time. They're going to go into their holes or their planets or their space stations or whatever and hide. But there are processes in place that are going to ensure that that will not happen, because it shouldn't happen.
No, no. E.T. has a say. E.T. and the EMVs have observed close understandings for eons. And basically they go like this. At a certain point in any system like this, where there is a class that is ruling over another class in the arbitrary manner they are here, and they go to consolidate their power past decency, past evolutionary restraints, then worse comes to worse, like depopulation or exchange of nuclear weaponry or whatever, which is insane.
Mm-hmm.
To that point, then what happens is the elements that are necessary to protect the planet from CMEs, from crust movements that can be catastrophic due to the vast cavities in the earth that have been caused by removing oil, from mining, from nuclear explosions beneath the surface, and a number of other things that you may not have been told about. These countermeasures to sustain enough stability that the people of the earth can survive will be removed. And when they're removed, it won't take long for this to all end.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can be in any hole. You can be anywhere. This lineage will be ended, because that's the way it's already happened 6 times here.
Mm-hmm.
And it can happen the 7th, and you're given a lot more leeway than you were in the other lineages, because this will be the last. If this doesn't work out, Jupiter and Jupiter's moons can use an extra source of energy for the solar system. And that will be this planet as it becomes a sun. And then you'll have a binary system. Then you'll have a binary system.
Now, that brings up a good point, because when you say that we are a partially manifested civilization, I don't think that people really understand what you mean by that. And in the context of what you just said, what you're saying is, we have not proven that we have the ability to get past ourselves with this kind of technology that we use. And so the model for the solar system we have now is not fixed, because our own place in it has not fixed yet. So there are contingencies in place for new models. And because this is the last time, which I believe myself, because I do believe that the amount of help that we're getting is indicative of that. So basically, if we don't fully manifest properly and do it right, then the model will shift a little bit so that others may have a chance to do so.
There is such a thing as a collective consciousness, and it's something that a culture builds. When it has a unified consciousness, the individuals begin to comply into a greater consciousness. You don't have that. That's what I mean when I say partial manifestation. And your reality is affected. I think there are many people on this earth that know there are things that are happening around them, including stellar formations, the constellations, the sun and the moon sometimes being out of alignment where
mm-hmm.
they should be, a
mm-hmm.
number of things going on that they will see. And this has to do with the aberrant mindset that is trying to form a collective consciousness and falls back out of whack with nature.
And it reminds me very much of what you say about the moon, how it doesn't maintain a constant gravity wave. So it feels very much like that here quite often, I would say. Like we're making progress and then we go backwards. It's like we're wobbling back and forth.
When the ancients were taught by the adepts, and when they had the saying, as above, so below,
mm-hmm.
when they had that, they meant far more than the literal mind today can conceive of.
I think there are some who are getting it.
There are. They're gifted people. You have to overcome the limits of your own ego. You really do. If you overcome the limits of your own ego, then that's the only time you can really submit to something that's new in the way of thought. There are a number of people that, for the life of them, they do not want to believe that there could be anything, the slightest grander, the slightest more developed, the slightest more advanced than themselves. They also happen to be the people that want to refute the existence of design or God or anything because they just know that they could be the ultimate. Well, there is a time of progression. Everybody has an immortal soul, and upon death, that is going to unite with the mind and become spirit and go someplace very marvelous where you're going to know the answers to just about everything that could perplex you here now. And that's something extraordinary to look forward to, and it doesn't matter. You know, a lot of people have a lot of problems with the idea of Hitler being there and Attila the Hun and Patrice Lumumba and so forth, but they're going to be there. But they won't be a reflection of what they were here. And people don't understand that.
That brings up something else. If we don't fully manifest, because we are the end of our lineage, and so you've talked about before that when, and people can get this from other shows if we don't have time to go into depth today, because I know you've covered it in other interviews that you've done, there's kind of a shared knowledge that happens when these souls get together in these chambers in these EMVs. But if we don't fully manifest this time, that information will not go into that collective consciousness because it's contaminated. Is that right?
Well, I hate to sound like a punisher. They'll go, but they will not have that. I mean, when there is joy to take with you, that lives. But when there's despair and longing and a sense of loss, that's left behind. And so it's a wonderful thing to have, you know, some touch of your lineage that you had. And of course, I've never talked about this before, but that's a form of punishment. It's not intended, but that's just the way it is. Who would want to take that vast sense of loss of having belonged to a failed experiment with you?
Well, and I don't know if punishment really is the right word, because if people get stuck, and we see this all the time with our loved ones, if they get stuck in something, if it's whether it's shame or regret, they don't get past it. They don't grow because they're stuck in that moment of having done this, that, or the other, and it can be difficult to forgive themselves. So it would almost seem a necessity to move on, I would think. And I know that a lot of people feel that way about reincarnation. Why don't we remember?
Well, I think since you brought reincarnation up, let me just inject this, Crystal, because I'd like to see what your take on this is.
Okay.
They might. Now, I don't know, but it's my guess that that might be the incentive. And it just occurred to me as you brought this up. That might be at least part of their incentive to reincarnate, because I can't imagine why they would ever want to leave the chambers, but they do.
And that becomes more understandable because you're saying that the only thing in the chamber is just joy. Yes, yeah. Why would you want to leave? But I personally think that in terms of reincarnation, that's why we don't remember, because we can't start over fresh and new if we're stuck in the old spaces. We carry that, you know, people call it baggage. But, you know, you get to start over fresh and do it again. And I think that's a gift. I don't see that as punishment myself.
I don't either. I've looked at it different ways, but having never been in a chamber and never an envy, you know, I envy people in the chambers. Having never been there, I can't really say. I mean, I can't say. I know things that I haven't discussed about that. And whenever someone asks me a question that comes closest enough to it, I'll respond and maybe we'll grow into that understanding together. But there are so many possibilities. Sometimes I even speculate my own little stories that I like to kind of build on because, you know, I'm no closer. I say this over and over again. I'm no closer to the face of God than you. But I speculate that maybe, just maybe, God set all this up and then went somewhere else to do it again, another universe, maybe. When you're talking about infinity, I mean, my God, what?
That's a big place.
Yeah. So maybe, and then the collective of these souls in these EMVs becomes the God here. You know, this is what he's leaving. These are the babysitters for the universe while he goes off somewhere else because he doesn't like redundancy. And, you know, and the universe doesn't like redundancy. So, you know, of course, I have no idea about whether or not that's true or not. But this is the kind of thing you speculate on when you are going from one place to another and it's taking a while, like a train ride.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Enjoy the ride, at least.
I wish, you know, if there's one thing that I haven't done on Earth lately that I would like to do again, it's take a long train ride. You know, go 600, 700 miles on a train, and I guarantee you, every thought that's up there in your skull that hasn't been nurtured properly is going to come to the fore and haunt you until it is.
And that's a good thing.
Oh, wonderful yeah. thing. Wonderful thing.
All right, James. Well, we've covered quite a bit here today, so maybe we should wrap it up. But if you're interested in continuing the series, I would like to, because I know that there are so many more important things that we also need to talk about. But I really thought if we could just get people kind of with us at this stage and put it all together in terms of who we are, where we came from. We haven't even discussed really in any depth how the anomalies in our solar system are connected to our ancestors coming here. And we also have some interference in what's going on here. And of course, the word ET does mean extraterrestrial, but there are distinctions that need to be made in terms of EBEs, extra biological entities that are not sentient, and then what we would call the extended community or our family. So I definitely want to get into that more next time if you would like to, because I think that's very, very important.
Certainly. Certainly.
Okay. I think we can wrap this one up.
All right.
It's March 20th, 2012, and I'm here with James Horak, and this is the second presentation in a series that we're doing. If you haven't listened to the first episode, I recommend it because there are things that we discussed there that we're not going to go over again here, and we're kind of building on some of those things. So, James, I want to kind of start with a story. I met a woman a few years back. She was the widow of a man that I had written about before. And I didn't know that he had passed over until we talked on the phone. And she told me this really beautiful story. He was a very spiritual man. He could see auras. He could speak to their animals. And she told me that she used to bug him all the time, please teach me how to see auras. And he would tell her, why do you want to see auras? That won't change anything. All people need to know is why people kill each other. But she was very persistent. And so one day he said, okay, go outside and sit in the sun and close your eyes. And after a while, you'll start seeing colors. So she said she went out there. She was out there for 5 minutes and then 15 minutes. And then after a half an hour, she went back in the house. And she said, I've been out there for half an hour and I don't see anything. And he said, that's because you don't have the preconditions. And the reason I'm sharing that story is because when we start talking about our ancestors and who they were and what they went through, that really does seem to be the precondition for bringing a lot of this together for a person, because it really is all connected. Not just the planetary anomalies that we have, or even our behavior now, the way we behave, but I think even some of the myths and legends that we've carried on through the ages that are just kind of strange. We don't know really where they came from. So it really kind of helps bring everything together. James, I want to drill down a little bit deeper into what we were talking about before. Our ancestors lived in another system, and then they came here. So how long ago was that when our ancestors left their system and came here?
On the moon, about 375,000 years ago, which seems like a long time But it's not a culture or civilization that has endured, has gotten over the hump, and has overcome its technology, like I talk about, where people live longer and where they have more options. And no one is under the burden to perform like they are here in ways which are denigrating, or which they're robbed of the luxury of their own time, time to learn, time to explore their own planet. I mean, you talk to a lot of people and they think that having gone out into the desert or done something when you were 9 or 10 years old that wasn't under adult guidance, they think that that's just beyond their capacity to understand. But these are the things that are very rewarding. These are the things that people should do when they feel they're ready to do them and not be overly supervised or what I would call regimented. Because when you...
Managed.
Yes. When you were put into a chute like a cow to be milked or slaughtered, and that's all you know. I mean, you look straight ahead. It's like having blinders on. And that conforming to social convention is bad enough. But when you have curriculums and syllabuses and so forth, it just becomes a horror. It becomes like denuding the potential of the human to less and less of freedom for self-expression, creativity, option. And when this is done, it's always at the expense of a person having what you were talking about earlier and what I call a power of expectation.
And this is something we can get more into also as we go on, because this is a pattern of behavior that our ancestors did not have when they came here. So that also helps us dial in on where that started and why we haven't let go of it yet. So I do want to talk about that, but I know it probably sounded strange when we, in the first episode, when we were talking about how our ancestors had gotten to a place where they were so advanced that they were engineering their solar system. But I think really that would just be a natural progression with technology, because we may start very small with, say, DNA, a smaller system. And we've done that already here. And of course, they're talking about geoengineering this planet in terms of weather. And of course, then the next phase would be other planets in your system. And then, of course, the sun. So it's a natural progression, and obviously, if there are problems in each phase, you may come to a very dire situation where you don't even make it to the next phase, or if there are problems along the way, each phase becomes a little bit more distorted, kind of like a building. It may not look crooked the first couple of layers of brick, but as you go, it starts to lean over and it will topple eventually. So they were engineering their solar system. I want to talk about that, because when we were talking about Mars, because they lived in a binary system and they were trying to apply the laws of that system to our system, they made an error and that began problems on Mars. But you mentioned that they had already successfully engineered a planet like that in their own system. So how did they do that? I mean, is this something that we would consider terraforming? So, and what I mean by how did they do that, I guess what I'm really asking is, was because a moon has to be involved. So, and also, why did they do it? Was it for expansion of their population?
The system that they were a part of was more complicated than the solar system here, since it was binary. One of the sun that was less prominent, had begun to change. And they were concerned about that. So they had set up a way of monitoring it and trying to determine, would it start producing energies in a realm that were harmful? Could it shrink and then expand rapidly and even explode? All of these things are possibilities, because they had observed this happening elsewhere. And the existence of EMVs at that time had not developed to the extent that it is now. EMVs had left this system because they were requested to. Essentially, your ancestors had begun to progress in a way that wanted to be self-sufficient in many things and did not want to incorporate into an extended community. The reasons for that really don't make any sense to me. Your ancestors had what is called a Council of Elders and Adepts. They hadn't had any kind of absolute monarchy or a central government for a long time. They had overruled that kind of dominion and had elected to have something very similar to what the ideal of a Senate is. Only these people were very respected scientists and men of letters that gave extremely remarkable presentations and speeches. And they were highly regarded. There wasn't the potential for corruption that exists here. And if corruption did come about, which it had from time to time, then it was dealt with very severely. But the problem basically was that in trying to find their own answers for a sense of accomplishment and self-edification, which would have become featured culturally, they began to try to do too much to correct things that, an extended community would have been there for them. EMVs would have been there for them. But they wouldn't resort to that. They felt that that was a crutch. They had a pride that didn't want to accept that sort of thing. And that doesn't happen anymore. I mean, because this was a keen lesson for cultures coming afterwards and that were concurrent at the time. To learn that you're never so big that you can't come to need help. And that was a model for remedying a situation that can crop up, can happen. And there are designs in everything, but sometimes those designs have to be implemented, modified to suit changes in conditions that you may not be able to control, but you can deal with. And that happens to solar systems throughout galaxies. It happens to systems everywhere. That's one of the things that make the idea of an extended community so important today. There are countless extended communities. There are countless planetary cultures and societies that are members of extended communities. This is a system that is predominant throughout the universe, and for obvious reasons.
That makes a lot of sense, because in the first show we did, you mentioned that our ancestors did not have the benefit of an extended community, and I was wondering, was that because extended communities weren't necessarily maybe the norm back then, but you said they actually refused help?
Yes. The concept of extended community goes back much further than your ancestors. Your ancestors were proud people, hard-headed, very inventive, creative, very beautiful, and they could have had help merely asking for it, but they thought they could handle it. They thought they could grow from handling it. It had become part of their spiritual makeup.
You had mentioned that they were engineering planets, but then they moved to engineering one of their suns, and they were trying to create something akin to a solar anvil. So even though they didn't maybe have relationships with the extended community, they were aware of the extended community at the very least.
Oh, yes, they dealt with other systems that were members of the extended community. Their situation where they were didn't make it very important to have a solar anvil in their system, because there were nearby systems that had solar anvils, and you don't need very many of them just in your general proximity. They basically wanted to have more and more control over both of their suns and to be able to moderate the changes that were going on in the lesser sun. That was a big mistake. We don't realize how integral in a system that the planets, moons, and suns in that case are. You change one, you change them all. It's interesting that you bring up the solar anvil, because what really tipped the scale in this case was an attempt to establish a constant gravity wave or something like a solar anvil in the lesser sun, which should never have been done. that was tampering with something unknown, because what happened is that it caused a compression, and this compression built up an energy level so high that it was dangerous to all the planetary life throughout that system. And there were a number of planets. There were cities and settlements and farms and industry. So that you had to be concerned about each and every one. In trying to deal with that, they made a big mistake. They created what you call a singularity. They created a situation that began absorbing matter and energy and wouldn't stop until there was an explosion of such a tremendous amount that there wasn't anything left. All the matter in that system particularized. It became so particulated, became a gas almost within seconds.
When that happened, literally billions of lives were lost.
Yes.
Just gone.
Yes.
So again, it's very lucky that some of our ancestors were planning and already had made their preparations to colonize a new section, because we wouldn't be here if that wasn't the case.
No. Today, I would say that there might have been people that had a prescience, that were in places of influence, and that managed to construct a moon in such a way. And by construct, I mean they're actually constructed.
There's something about the anvil and that story that really fascinated me. And again, for people who may not be familiar with this, the sun itself is not a stargate, but it has a partner that you call the anvil that can be used for something similar.
No sun in itself can be a stargate or a portal, because the fluctuations that are involved in any fusion don't permit a constant enough gravity wave to be a signature, and that's what's used to navigate to and from it. So you want to build a stationary port-like structure, and yet at the same time you want to be able to use the sun's energy to focus it. The magnitude of energy is important, but being able to focus this energy in direct and controlled ways is more. It's the most important element in stellar technology. And if you can do this, then you don't have any energy problems. You don't have any travel problems. You don't have problems, period. If you can maintain that as a stable known, then your system is secure, your energy needs are secure, your communication needs, because you can use the sun to send communications, to transport, to anything you want to do. It's limitless. There are astrophysicists today that put technical levels of advance of a culture, civilization, into three stages. We're just beginning the second stage, but in the third stage, you have control over your star, or in this case, stars.
And that's really interesting. I had never heard you say where a solar anvil comes from. So actually, I was almost under the impression that maybe it was a natural phenomenon that just kind of went along with the sun, but it's not. They actually have to be engineered. Is that what you're saying?
There's more engineering in the solar systems than people can realize. I was recently asked about this triangle-looking thing that was being seen in the sun, and somebody asked me what it was, and I said, well, the sun is being cooled. It's being cooled down, and so when this happens, you can see sometimes substructure. That infers, of course, engineering. That infers modification to the sun. And, of course, over a period of time, you're dealing with a fusion star that can be very temperamental. And in order to maintain a constant energy level relatively with respect to planets and moons, sometimes you have to actually build structures. And if you turned out the lights on the sun, and if you knew what the internal structure of the moon looked like, you would see something resembling a geodesic dome. And that's because over periods of millions of years, it had become necessary in order to have the source of life, which is your star, and at the same time keep it relatively constant in its supply of energy and not have it become renegade or hyperactive or whatever, because that can destroy everything in instance. You have to go in and do some hard work.
That's, if you know how.
I talk about the EMVs a lot because they're what do it.
Right.
even the highest level of civilizations that exist need them from time to time. They're essential. There'd be no duration. There would be no longevity to any system whatsoever long enough to produce cultures and civilizations to get even as far as where Earth is right now, if there weren't EMVs. If science actually did their homework on this and drew the projections that they need to do based on models that they can compile with data, they would know, or they'd admit, you know, in their honest moments, that every 17 years, the likelihood of a CME hitting the Earth that would devastate it, ultimately, one side instantly, the rest of the planet within 2 weeks, would be so highly likely that it would be probable, so that you would figure that even when you were very lucky, within a period of 25 or 30 years, you could expect to have most life forms denuded on a planet that was that near to a star. And Earth is that near to a star. In fact, we almost had Mercury just charred a couple of months ago, or less, and a CME protected it physically.
An EMV, you mean?
Yeah, an EMV. In my mind, I don't think of these as abbreviations or whatever. I think of them like...
I'm sure you're probably picturing them while you're talking.
I do. And to see an EMV actually cradle a planet like Mercury to protect it is one of the most wonderful things you can see.
I can imagine. I can only imagine at this point. So let's make a mental note. Never ask the EMVs to leave our system again.
No,
let's not do that again.
You don't want them to. They are looked on with awe by ET. In fact, they don't even like to talk about them because it's humbling. It's humbling. The more self-sufficient you become, the more removed from the hardships and the, let's say, the embarrassing things that your culture went through to get where you are now. It's like with anything. After the lessons are learned, you want to forget the hardship of learning them. It's like a bad taste in your mouth. And so they have different ways of referring to the EMVs. They can't approach them. And there's a reason for that. They're acknowledged as part of nature. You know, it's an interesting thing to speculate that ET has come to terms of balance. That when you overcome your technology, you stop trying to make better and better weapons. And when you really develop culturally to where you can sustain peace and you can sustain harmony and you can sustain higher values and be a model for your children and not have to worry about them being taught. When you're not contradicting, say, your Ten Commandments like they do here on Earth, you don't have problems. It takes a little while. Aberrancy, criminal behavior, and things that we have laws against here but somehow indulge. They go away. They go away. Most social evil is caused from the way the system is. It's not caused because individuals are born and shaping into iniquity and all that crap. It's primarily because someone is injured or abused at a very early age, and they compensate for that in aberrant ways.
Yes, and the split consciousness being exploited isn't really helping.
Well, the split consciousness plays a bigger part in this than most people realize, but I didn't bring this up because in the past few years, I have, and ET has, come about realizing that there are benefits, that there are things that are very valuable and even alluring in many ways to ET going on here that would be very wonderful if they could be incorporated into a way of life that is over the hump, that is over this madness. The question is, can the split consciousness be tamed? I think if you have the right system, it can be. And I don't want to see it eliminated. You know, I taught unified consciousness and tried to develop the model for it and other people. I didn't have a lot of luck, but I did succeed in certain ways. And I think that if people want to emulate something very strongly, they don't have to worry about being taught to kill or being taught to interrogate or all of the bad things, if they don't see this go on. I mean, we have children that are learning awful behavior with video games. I don't blame things on video games. I blame things on the people that put other people in war, in the battle, that create problems for profit, that do inhumane things out of disregard for human life, and by placing material values above spiritual and human values. If you don't have these conflicts, if you don't have these false values, where you have to betray the social contract and you have to enforce laws selectively and you have corruption to the extent that doing anything about all of these inequities has become impossible, then you advance. You advance to a point, I think, even with split consciousness, where you can get to a point that you're not going to return back to this narcissism, this elitism, this rule of tyrants, of having people just gradually steal more and more of your rights as a human, and to the point where they want to take your life because, in their terms, you are a useless eater.
Now, James, I think that split consciousness and how that developed, I think, really helps people understand what's really happening. And what I mean by that is, when we look at the story of our ancestors coming out here and not having access to helium in a new environment, that's when the split consciousness began. And at that same time, you had a portion of the population that began to recognize that people were more controllable under those circumstances. And at the same time, I would imagine that this is where things like envy and jealousy and all of these other things that our ancestors may have actually gotten past.
These tendencies are always there. They're there in ETs to some extent. However, there are ET civilizations that get beyond the carnal.
Mm-hmm.
They do. I don't see that as being extremely wonderful, but it does simplify a lot of things.
But it does make me wonder, James, if this is where at least this particular group of people really began to develop the God complex. I mean that in the sense of power over others. And to this day, it still affects us. And especially if you look at all of this terrorism garbage, because in order for somebody to have that kind of a complex and abuse it the way they do, there always has to be an enemy that they have to save you from, because that's part of the complex, to be the savior. But it also requires withholding technology, withholding knowledge, withholding history.
Withholding option. I get you in that chute. Make you think that that's the only option that exists and that's something wrong with you if you don't go along with it. That's what we've got now.
So they hoard wealth. They hoard knowledge. The state becomes your god.
They're better than you. They can be wiser. They're taking self-determination out of your hands and using it because they're of a bloodline. You see, the lies that are behind everything that they do really come into focus when you look at the Gulf of Mexico or Fukushima, mm-hmm. or all of these tests, fracking, all of the things that are going on now that obviously to anyone paying attention and thinking about it is leading to a devastation of the planet. Mm-hmm. And war is part of that. Right now, we had a president come into office on a platform that he was going to change things. We all thought it would be for the better. It's been for the worst. He has taken more license, committed more treason, more abuse of power than all administrations before put together, including the New Deal under FDR. When one stops and thinks about what was passed, and until it's challenged, is executive law, executive made by the Penn Law on the 16th of this month, this is the highest treason that has existed in any country that has not gone through a palace revolution. What we have seen is an absolute act of treason against every element of social contract, every element of checks and balances in our way of government that has been put in place since the Constitutional Convention of 1789. We do not have a division of powers. We do not have any of the things that has kept this country able to correct its problems in the past. We are on the fast track to having lost everything that the American value is based on.
That's very, very true. And I think, again, it's really important to recognize that it's the same pattern. I mean, how long ago was that when all of this happened on Mars? We're still...
Even then, it was an equitable society. The problem didn't begin until after about a few thousand years before the migration from Mars to Earth was completed. During that time, a caste system came into being.
And it's never left.
Yeah. Well, there was a split in the Council of Elders. There were some that didn't want to come to Earth, wanted to stay on Mars, because they were very involved in the Druge. And they actually toyed with the notion of trying to metamorph as a Druge. And their wisdom was lost. These were people that were brought up and taught, that had prescience, that had virtues that were so elegant. And they, as this exodus took place, became more and more enamored with the Druge and less concerned with the plight of their own people. This caste system got started because they were losing these elders that wanted to incorporate as Druge, wanted to become spirit, wanted to become a spiritual reality intact. I saw the same thing with Romans towards Etruscans. Same identical thing. Roman society was brutal compared to the Etruscan, and there were many very intelligent, well-educated Romans that gave up on Roman society, the brutality of it all, and took up with the Etruscans. And of course, the Etruscans are always into partying and conversations, elegant debates, and so forth. They lost themselves. Well, your elders did the same thing on Mars with the Druge. Of course, the Druze thought that that was fine. They believed in free will. They were impressed with the power of the human mind. They were very rare people themselves.
You know, what I think is so important about this information, James, is because hiding it has been a big part of exploiting the split consciousness for power over others. Because so many of the things that you're explaining are things that have been used to divide us. Especially yes. In terms of religion. In fact, it answers a lot of anomalies because we know that in Scripture, it talks about our ancestors living longer. And that's actually a fact. But I think it's probably been a little embellished in the Scriptures as far as how long they lived. But they did live longer. We just don't know why anymore. So I think that's really important. You know, people have written about a group called the Procyllines, a time before the moon was put into orbit. That may sound really strange, but it's a fact. It helps explain a lot. Where the God complex began, I think, for the elite, I think that's explained. And another really interesting thing, and you and I had actually talked about this privately after the last show, but I asked you, what did the Druge look like? Do you mind telling people?
Well, it's interesting. When I've been among the Druge, you can tell the difference between the men and women. I assume that there was a difference. They wore a very tight-fitting suit that looked like silver. They could see through it, so you didn't see their eyes. You could see that they had something like a nose. Their features are regular, arms, legs, and beautiful hands, long tapered fingers. I could never make out their feet because the suit would come out and form a kind of a toe, and you couldn't see if they even had toes. I don't know.
I see.
You never talked to a Druge about his appearance or physical parts because they were removing themselves from that.
Right. I think the connection, though, is that that may very well be where our story of angels being sexless came from. It's an encounter we had thousands and thousands of years ago with another race.
You believed in angels long before the Exodus and long before he even came to this system.
Did we?
That was a tradition that went back. Of course, it's a little bit different. There's so many traditions that you have kept for 500,000 years. Legends and myths, very colorful. You kept them long after most ETs would have they would have become lost. And I think that that probably was because your ancestors had a vitality, a physical vitality that was very impressive. You got your way a lot among ETs because you would get emotional about things in ways ETs weren't. Your ancestors were robust. They were highly capable, a beautiful people. But you had unified consciousness until about the middle of the period of exodus from Mars to Earth. And I think that the desire to put the moon in orbit around the Earth had a lot to do with that coming about, the split consciousness, and then the corrections not being made in the settings of the machines on Mars and on the moon and on Earth.
Let's talk about that a little bit more, James, because the Druze helped our ancestors, and because they made miscalculations with Mars, Earth became the next suitable home, and the Druze helped our ancestors tame the Earth so that they could come here and live. But that would require, on the part of the Druze, I would think, some very advanced knowledge of our physiology. So I wanted to ask you about something, because you've mentioned before that there were 144 of those engines put here on the Earth. And of course, you know, Revelation in Scripture talks about that number quite a bit. Now, I, a few years ago, had purchased an original manuscript of Edgar Cayce's where he talked about the number 144, and he mentioned that in decoding Revelation, the 144,000 was actually about our physiology. At one point, he broke it down to selected bodily cells bearing the pattern for perfect development. And I really like the way that seems to kind of fit with the design of the engine. So can you tell us more about that?
There have been astrologers that were seers as well as astrologers, just like there have been alchemists that were chemists and early physicists, so to speak. One doesn't necessarily have to preclude the other. Of course, in modern science's view, which isn't so modern, they have this attitude that you either think like them or you're a wacko. What's interesting is that there are people that are elegantly far beyond what these modern scientists here on Earth are, and they are not nearly as narrow and confined and boxed in. They understand this perfectly well, and they still, of course, can't explain anything about the EMVs or what's going on there, but they just know that this is part of nature, and they know to leave them alone. If they need anything, if they want help or whatever, there's a protocol that they use to get it, but they don't ever approach an EMV or get in their way.
Okay, let's refine this a little bit more. Is there a connection with the number of engines and our physiology?
Oh, yes.
Do you want to elaborate on that?
When everything is going right, the composition, and the Druze worked this out, the composition of your respirant is perfect. It's just like what you evolved in. And by evolved, I don't mean from a lower form animal to a human. I mean from an early human with sentience to one that was most suited, that had the traits most suited to survive in your environment. People have to understand sentience is very rare. And I've been around, and I have a firm belief that it comes from one place throughout the universe. It all comes from one place. Of course, that is difficult to comprehend when you're dealing with people that at one time believed in bilateral evolution of mankind on one little planet. Mm-hmm. And if you think about how absurd that is.
Well, I think, again, because not really understanding our past, because you've mentioned that there were other races here, that didn't mean that it was a split in our own race. No. It's important that we begin to have a broader view. We can't accept things like that.
We want to believe that the grain of sand is going to turn into a human mind in time. You know, millions and billions or whatever, you know, do the Carl Sagan crap. That all it takes is enough time and chance. That isn't true.
Right. And just in case people don't know, James, explain sentience. What do you mean when you use that word? Because I don't want people to get it confused with consciousness the way people use that word today.
Sentience reflects on cognition and how cognition can follow a direction, incorporate values, incorporate priorities. That's an extension of values. And it can reason beyond the particular individual. It can think in terms of the collective. It can begin to grow in terms of socialization of one species to another. All of these things, you see elements of this in animals. But man differs in that as a gregarious species, he has certain elemental distinctions between other animals. One is preservation of the species. You know, we do have one or two animals that have it akin to the way man has it. But the full complement of everything that it takes in a sense of building cities, monuments, the collective is unique to man. Now, you see herding instincts, you see animals that, for all we know, are approaching sentience or may have it, but they don't have the means to deliver it, like bipeds with the articulated thumb and things. I mean, we have the full complement to accomplish these things and carry them beyond there. If you had a dolphin, for instance, with the reticulated thumb, who knows what that guy could do?
Yeah.
You can't eliminate possibility, but I think that sentience comes from one place. I think it's so rare, exceedingly rare, that it comes from one place. In the variations that we see, we think too often as having generated from the grain of sand or whatever. I don't think that that is any more plausible than 150 years ago, or less than that, 100 years ago, when geologists were trying to build a case for bilateral evolution. For the black man, the brown man, the yellow man, all evolving separately. And that's the biggest yarn. I mean, today, people have the sophistication generally to understand how absurd that is.
They don't share it, though.
No, they don't. I mean, you got people that are still trying to place the age of the Earth at 6,000 years. I mean, there's no help for them.
Let's talk about that, James, because I'm sure that people may have this question eventually. And I've mentioned this to you before, because I thought it was interesting that when people were going through Edgar Cayce, when you go through the views of others that are limited, you're still getting limited views, even if they're beyond your limitations. There's still a little bit of a limitation. And he had told people that the five brute races were created at once. Now, it sounds more like our ancestors arrived all at once. But even then, we have the ability to adapt to our environment. And so you see people that live in a certain location longer develop a uniqueness that helps their physiology deal with the elements in that area.
Well, let's use a hypothetical.
Okay.
There are people that are so far away that the only meaningful way in which they can interfere or they can propagate in systems like ours is by radio. So they send a radio wave that is carried on a light wave with information or data that is poignant enough to affect cell structure and DNA. So they send this, and it's got a pattern of them, because that's the way people like that like to interfere. They think that they have something really spectacular to offer, and they know that there's this planet out there that is being engineered for life or whatever, and they want to get in on the act. So they beam this intelligence or this data or whatever.
Right,
they
right.
beam it, and it travels. And it may take 100,000 years to get here, and it's traveling at the speed of light, of course. So it gets here, and it hits some protoplasm, or it hits something, whatever, which ends up affecting life in some way. Suddenly, you have a creature that is very early man-like, because he has to contend with his environment, so he is specifically best through natural selection. Over maybe thousands of years, he becomes able, but he does have the seed of sentience with him. and then someone better comes along, all of the ideas of progress here can get thrown out the window, because in the middle of it all, we had a person here on this planet that had a more extensive cranial cavity than Homo sapien. That was Cro-Magnon. Very refined tools, very refined art, but he wasn't warlike enough to exist against Neanderthal, so he got killed out, and of course, Neanderthal took his women. Procreated with his women, and there might be a lot of people here on this planet right now that have a very close genetic makeup to this combination between Cro-Magnon and Neanderthal. Maybe that's what we're electing to the House of Representatives. But not that they aren't smart. I've met people that are very intelligent people, and they have this brow line and shape of their head kind of stooped, that they would pass for Neanderthals, but they are brilliant people, very nice mm-hmm. people. There is a mix here.
That's what I was going to say. So we're not all just transplants from our ancestors, is what you're saying.
From time to time, you have a craft crash here. You had one crash that was very large and had a lot of people, and they kind of took subterfuge in the Grand Canyon. And there's a story about what they did there. Now, they may have survived and moved elsewhere and been part of the early shaping of a society or something that had a part in the earliest lineage here at the time of your ancestors. When your ancestors came here, there were people here already.
That's the $50,000 question.
Yeah. There have been separate species here.
Now, you've mentioned that we've had this self-destruction thing happen 6 times before.
Yes.
In the gaps in between, are there also people visiting in between when we come back? And how long are those gaps?
About 25,000 years. About 25,000 years. Maybe a little less, maybe a little more. One of them was about 15,000 years. One of them was about 30,000 years. It's not regular. It's not clockwork. It takes a while for certain things to happen which make a presentable enough environment to start a new lineage, because in almost every case, the same factors occurred that eliminated most life on the planet, and that was that the EMVs withdrew from the sun.
Mm-hmm. So it just takes time for everything to become reestablished.
That's right.
Okay. That's right. Now, during those periods, do we get visitors? Here on this planet.
Yes, yes. You're always getting visitors.
This is important, I think, for people maybe studying anthropology and whatnot, because all of these anomalies that they don't want to look at because they can't fit it into our timeline, well, that doesn't mean they aren't important. Don't try to fit them all into our timeline.
The timeline is, you bring that up. Actually, I'll tell you, I believe in cause and effect. I believe in determinism. I mean, these are like the hand in front of your face.
Mm-hmm.
But there has been, you know, what I say about time travel. Why don't you tell the people what I say about time travel? You've heard it from me so many times.
If time travel is possible, ever will be possible, it's with us now.
Yes, yes. Yes. Well, it's a fact of life, but you have to understand it's something that has to be controlled, and whenever the continuum is tampered with, things have to be set right. The hydrogen bomb creates a tear in time, and there's a reason for that. Oppenheimer figured that out, and that's why he refused to work on a hydrogen bomb. That and the fact that he could see that this type of thinking, that whatever it is, no matter how bad it is, we got to get there first, would eventually lead to the destruction of the planet. And it is.
Mm-hmm. James, I wanted to ask you about this because I began noticing it in 2010. The planets not lining up in the right spot, the sun and the moon doing weird things. And I had already talked about it in shows that I had done before you and I actually met. And I was also under the impression that it is consciousness. It doesn't stay one way or the other, because it's like a crab coming out of the water and then he goes back in. We haven't really gelled anything yet. So I had that feeling myself, which you mentioned during the last show that we did, I've heard you say, what raised an eyebrow for me is in a show that you did with Tom and Ramon, where you said that things like HAARP, and in this case, the hydrogen bomb, create tears in time. And so I'm wondering how much of that needs to be also considered in this equation.
I cannot emphasize enough the power of expectation. Humankind expects things to roll out chronologically, and they will see something, and they will apply this power of expectation to it and work it out in their minds when the reality might be the opposite, the exact opposite. And that's what becomes their reality.
Mm-hmm.
And it may not be what's in front of them at all, but because you're gregarious, because you have established a collective consciousness of sorts, it becomes the consensus.
Okay, I see. And so the reality keeps changing because the consensus keeps changing, I would think.
Oh, yes. I mean, if you don't believe me, think about that it's only been in the past, I would say, 15 years that people have been seeing UFOs to any extent at all. And now they see them every day. They see them in profusion. They see them doing different things. They see groups of them. They see all sizes, all configurations. It's been going on the same way all along. The only thing that is different is that the consensus is allowing people to discuss them. Consensus is allowing people to admit to themselves they're there.
To remove the psychic block.
Huh. Yeah.
Right, right.
Well, that's a big part of it, but it's also building an appreciation for a reality that was denied. You deny the possibility of something, you won't see it. That's the crux of the psychic block. I call that incredulity because you need some name to tack on to that. But basically what it is psychic blocking. Now, it can be used externally on you as mind control. And then you can actually, you know, now that they have the ability to surgically remove, by surgically, I mean particularly, remove short-term memory, and they can reimplant the scenario in there that you firmly believe happened to you. I call it broadcast mind control.
Right, which is very, very prolific now. But I want to go back and make this other connection because we were talking about the planets not being in the right space, and it doesn't last for very long, usually a couple of weeks, and that it will go back to the way it was. So are you implying that it already has changed? It's just that we're
I'm implying
just
that you're putting it back.
It.
When people get alarmed, they know where it should go. Their power of expectation puts just it back the way it should be.
Okay. That makes more sense. Okay.
Yeah.
What's disturbing it may be some of these technologies they're using, but as long as we know that it can be fixed. And I think that's another thing, too, is that, you know, we often say, and I say it more than you do because my view is different, that ET is not going to fix anything for us. But that's not entirely true. I mean, that's a half-truth. Well, look at the EMVs, right? If there's a problem with the sun, they fix it. If we do something to mess it up, I'm sure they'll fix it. But there are limitations, but we do have help, and I think that's important.
Now, I keep expressing this and trying to stress it to tell you where the line is. Because if you go over this line, it's over.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's important because we are getting help. And I do want you to clarify that because I don't want people to be confused about it. They do help us. And we would not, I don't think, have gotten this far without it. But there is a line, and I would very much like for you to explain that.
Well, twice you would have had World War III. But when the attempts to launch ICBMs occurred, nothing would work. And there are people that know exactly what I'm referring to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's highly explosive to say what I've just said, but, you know, it's a fact. I'm not exaggerating or anything. And it shouldn't come as a surprise to anybody after all the saber rattling that's gone on over the last 12 years.
That's true. I mean, mutually assured destruction really was mad, but it was accepted.
That's a reality. When you have nations like Russia today and United States and a collection of nations like Israel, France, England, so forth, that have a contingent arsenal of nuclear weapons. The idea that if somebody starts throwing those around, that there would be a limited exchange is just insane. Eventually, somebody's going to let loose with everything they've got, and everyone else is. And that's the end. Nobody's going to worry about putting this planet back together again when that happens. It's just going to let this become another sun, and this will be a binary system. Hopefully we won't find out what a binary system is.
Hopefully we won't.
Believe me, this is the furthest wish in the minds of ETs. This is the furthest wish in the minds of the blondes, who are ETs too. Everybody in the extended community, EMVs alike, wish the best. They're there. They're hoping that you'll overcome your technology, that you'll overcome this narcissistic system.
In fact, let's look at that, because I want to paint a very clear picture of our situation based on what you just said. Even the extended community wants us to do well. We're talking about people out in the universe want us to do well. The only people that don't want us to do well are the people in charge of the planet.
You know, I'm going to name some of these people. You have people that want to believe in doom. They will take the work of a fraud. They will take mythology, and they will build out of it a doom, and they want to believe in it. And it reminds me about one of the sequels to The Planet of the Apes, where these people are worshiping a hydrogen bomb. And why anybody would want to do that, I have no idea. I once said that it might be true that he who lives by the sword dies by the sword. He who lives by the hydrogen bomb will die by it. That might be true, but you don't want to believe it, do you? You want to consign yourself to doom?
I don't really understand that. And of course, you know, that's a big frustration of mine, because always the doom from space when the problem is here on this planet.
The problem is here, but it doesn't make any difference. I can remember back in the 50s when there were a number of intelligent people that just knew that it was going to come to a nuclear exchange. It almost did over the Cuban crisis. Mm-hmm. Thank God that the Kennedy brothers stood up against Westmoreland and said no. He wanted to launch. When you understand that there are people that are absolutely off their rocker with that kind of power, and that there are people that other people look up to just because they've got money, like Bill Gates and Ted Turner, who talk about depopulation. Well, the world might be better off without you, Mr. Turner, and you, Mr. Gates.
You know, that's so funny, because I've expressed that exact sentiment in the first book I wrote, Who Really Are the Worthless Eaters? When you look at it that way. Who is it that doesn't contribute anything positive to the betterment of our race?
Well, you know, there are a lot of hackers out there that would agree with you about Mr. Gates.
Well, I think we should wrap this up, James. People should have a lot to think about before we do the next one. And I know that we were entertaining the idea of having people submit questions that they would like asked. So how do you feel about that? Would you still like to do that?
Oh, that's fine. Surely.
Okay, we have the blog, which is www.emvsinfo.blogspot.com for people to send those questions to. So thank you very much, James, and we'll talk again soon.
Thank you, Crystal.
It's March 28th, 2012, and I'm here again with James Horak. This is the third presentation in a series that we're doing about our history as human beings and how that ties in with some of the anomalies in our solar system. There's one more thing we have to talk about, James, and this is the EBE problem that we have. The EBE situation is something that is very important for people to understand. Not that it makes sense in a sane way, but it does kind of make some sense from the perspective that the people that are running the planet really do operate from the God complex place. In order for them to have power over everyone else, they have to hoard things and deny the rest of us things, whether it's food, clean water, free energy, knowledge of our past, technology, really pick something. They've hidden a great deal. And the EBEs and the ETs are not the same thing, although our world leaders, perhaps that may be too broad of a term, are working with EBEs. And I would say that that feeds their God complex. So let's talk about that. Tell us the difference between an EBE and an ET, James.
Sentience. An EBE is nothing but chunks of meat sewn together with a computer terminal. And that's basically what they are. They try to get in people's minds, and they succeed generally. Some people they can't. And I have a built-in sort of weapon that I use on them because they revolt me. And
that's part of your design, which is nice, I'm sure.
Yeah, it's worked very well when I was 4 years old.
Let's talk about why the EBEs are here. What are they doing here?
Well, this is their last subterfuge. They have run out of systems all over this part of the galaxy because they've caused problems. They're problematic. They're not hostile, but they are problematic because they have renegated from a purpose they were designed for 90,000 years ago. There was a civilization that created them before pioneering deep space travel. His civilization was too humane to send its own people out when they knew they wouldn't be back with their families and restored to their culture. So they designed an EB. If you look at an EB, he is economic.
A very efficient probe because it has hands. It can pick things up. It's not like these machines, like the Mars rover, you know. It's a very efficient design if you think about it.
And if they crash or whatever, they are not able to communicate theory or to give technical explanation about their technology. That's why this back engineering has been so unsuccessful. The EBs are involved in trying to recapture what they never really understood. They maintain their craft. They maintain the electronics. They maintain elements that they have to use for what they do. They're sent out. They take information and send it back. And as of the last 50,000 years, they haven't had anything to report or anybody to report to. I joke they started watching I Love Lucy or something and went nuts. I ought to take that back because there are some good people that like I Love Lucy. But no, something like that happened and they have become aberrant. They're not hostile. But they interfere, they corrupt systems where people are progressing from monument building or from what would represent your Stone Age, the Bronze Age, to the Iron Age and beyond. And they just play havoc. They did that here, and they don't know how to behave, so to speak. And so they know they're being hunted. They know that if they try to leave Earth in one of their craft, for instance, and there are no humans aboard, that ET's going to demolish them.
And I think that's important because not only are they using us, but we have people here on this planet using them. And I think, again, it goes back to the God complex in terms of hoarding technology, when in reality, it's theater because they're sending people out into the world to have all of us believe that they have technology that is just so advanced, but in fact, it's not theirs.
Now, you understand certain elemental things about what science here can and cannot do. It cannot create the metal that is necessary to travel at speeds to take you from one star system to the other. Can't do that, and EB can't give them that. Their craft has the metal, but humans cannot navigate an EB craft. They cannot. No. They may have, listening to me, figured out the principle behind the drive navigation, but the synapses between the EB and the craft is essential, and a human can't do it. So these craft have to be navigated by an EB. Because it's a built-in safeguard. The people right. that created the EBs created safeguards so that the EB could not pollute a civilization, could not contaminate it, could not change its development and create the problems that we see here. Of course, it's polemical here. Even though the EBs have complicated matters, and they are an argument that I use with ET to be indulgent with man here, because they have to an extent. But you have an element here that no matter what, whether there were EBs or not, has become insane. And these are the people that control the institutions of the system.
I think this is really important. All the EBs have become to these people is another tool of control, which is why they keep them around. It keeps the illusion going.
That, and I think that the main use of EBs today is that people mistake them for ET. It's a lot easier to script the EBs as hostile ETs.
Which goes back to, we're your savior because there's hostile ETs.
Yeah. They're fighting against common sense. I keep saying this, but it's not getting across. Yeah. We decided that we would let you make a ruinous trash dump of Earth, and then we want it?
Yes, and there's two other things about that that I want to mention, is the way that we have explained, even our own ancestors and their level of technology, it was so far advanced that if there really were hostile ETs, it would not be a war, it would be a slaughter. We don't have the kind of technology that we would need. They're way too advanced. So if they were going to attack, I think they would have done it already.
Crystal, there are different kinds of evolution. If you approach star travel technology, where one person can, in their little hand, have the power to destroy a planet, and you haven't changed, you haven't come up, you haven't gotten over the hump, that person is going to come about, and that planet is going to be destroyed. It is a dead, cold, harsh inevitability. And one thing eliminates the other. One problem eliminates the other problem. That is evolution of a sort. Yeah. So you can bet that all these cultures that are here from other star systems that we see here every night.
And have seen for thousands of years.
They don't commit war. They don't commit aggression.
No, because if they were aggressive and they were in the process of trying to develop their own technology, they would have abused it and destroyed themselves the same way we are.
That's right. That's right.
So that makes complete sense. But the other thing that I really want to point out here, too, is that I know that people are very concerned about the EBE presence, especially in terms of abductions. But the point that we're trying to make is, if we deal with the monsters that use all these tools, the EVEs being one of them, it all goes away, even that.
Well, McElroy, a state legislator who was on one of these committees, who had access to some classified briefings, talks about Eisenhower's meeting with ETs. And they were trying to convince President Eisenhower that these guys are problematic, we'll get rid of them for you. And, of course, the military's present, and they ask the ETs, well, will you give us technology? And they said no, because that isn't allowable. So they said, well, the EBs will give us technology, and it's done us a lot of good. This is a two-edged sword. There are certain things that are attributed that we would have discovered anyway. I mean, Tesla, of all people. Tesla, at the turn of the century, at the turn of the 19th into the 20th century, Tesla had more understanding, more science than EBs. Because EBs do nothing but run what's already built and report back to home with information that they find, send images, so forth. That's all that they can do. They have no personality. They have no sense of cognition. They're things. They're things. And, you know, they don't mean harm. They don't mean well. They're just there. But they get in the way. And they've gotten in the way here. So they need to be cleaned up. They don't need to be allowed to go somewhere else and do this somewhere else because they've done it elsewhere.
But the point is that the same people that use HARP, that want depopulation, are also the same people that use EVs as a tool. It's just another tool in their box. And so when we get to a place where we don't allow people like that to run our planet, that situation will be dealt with at the same time.
You'll set up formal relations with ET when you do that, and they'll help you. That doesn't mean they're going to give you a better weapon.
No.
No. They'll ask for elimination of certain things, like reactors and so forth. They'll teach you how to use your sun. Also teach you a number of things, very interesting things that I don't feel free to discuss.
And I don't blame you. And I think that's something that people really need to think about is what giving up our say in a future is costing us.
Yeah.
It's cost us longevity, which is really important because we don't ever really get to finish. We get cut off too soon. It's cost us genius. It's cost us progress. And we don't even really know. I mean, what's so helpful about these conversations is that we get a glimpse of things that we can't conceive of because there are so many restrictions on the bubble from the inside. And I think people really need to ask themselves, why do we tolerate what we tolerate? In exchange for what?
Well, people have to understand the real reason behind why the monsters have kept the ET reality from the public, what the real reason is.
It would displace their power center.
That's right. It would open up people to options. It's not fearful. What's fearful is the unknown. But when you understand that the same nature that you see when you walk out in your backyard, and if you're a farmer, that you see going on with your animal, that this exists throughout the universe. And when things are right, they're right for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
When they're wrong for everyone. We have here people that have an illusion of happiness that is based on something that is its own end, its own destruction.
That's right. That's right. And people themselves will participate in, for example, what's going on with these elections. It's painfully obvious that whether you like Ron Paul or not, he's being robbed of any real chance in so many different ways. So the elections are rigged. Now, it's disturbing to me that an individual would let that go just because they don't like Ron Paul. Well, if you let it go, what's going to happen next time? They're going to do it again. I mean, that's the thing. I heard someone say once that if you really wanted to look at this as a war for souls, the proper way to look at it is every time you see something that you know is wrong and you don't do something about it, you lose a little piece of your soul.
Well, that's true. Imagine the hell that these people are going through because they don't have the courage to call the police or speak out when they see somebody being beaten to death or mugged. I wouldn't want to live with that. Mm-hmm. And there are plenty of people that are. The situations that we have put people into in Afghanistan, for instance, young men and women that we've sent over there. And I was appalled to find out just this week that as of the last year or so, the mortality statistics over there, more people were committing suicide than were being killed by enemy fire.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's been going on for a while.
So if you want to convert that into realistic terms, and terms you may not like but are absolutely true, their leaders are killing their own warriors at a higher rate than the enemy is.
Yes.
The American people have not been given a moral equivalent as to cause for any of these wars. And they're paying a price.
And we've been so segregated, and that's the mentality that drives it, because people will say, well, that's not happening to me, so why should I care? Well, you should care because eventually it will come back to you. It just, the monster just grows.
Well, the damage that the war in Vietnam did, I had so many friends that I lost, and so many people that I know had their lives just utterly destroyed from a war that never had a real justification. And the only justification that was ever used was a lie. And today we find out that it was absolute fabrication. But it doesn't seem to click with people that, you know, all of these wars that we've been engaged in since World War II fit into that category.
Mm-hmm.
Every single one of them.
Yes, and I think that this also is so much easier to get people to do by exploiting split consciousness. And it may be a somewhat simplified way to explain it when we say the left brain and the right brain themselves are opportunized in different ways. Because, you know, here in this country, We are right-handed, and we're taught to write from left to right, which constantly reinforces use of the left brain. If you just look at how that is exploited in a human being, and you blow that up on the larger stage, we've cut our own planet into two different hemispheres. We have the East and we have the West, and they're at war with each other, just like the human being is within self.
Well, it goes deeper than that. You have an antagonism, a fear of the conscious mind or the subconscious, because the subconscious is not the social part of the mind. And from the age of 2 years old, we are taught, we are entrained that we have to follow a certain set of rules in order to be socially acceptable. And mm-hmm. we can't be too truthful. We can't be candid because we'll hurt Auntie's feelings. Tell the paper boy I'm not here. And all this, and this cuts deep into the child's natural reactions. It causes them to be hesitant. This furthers the gap between the two minds. So you have this balancing act between the subconscious and the conscious going on, with the conscious mind having possession most of the waking hours, and mm-hmm. all that time it is shutting out the subconscious, and our everyday conversation is correcting the dissembling and the lying that we do in our forward speech with reverse speech. Now, yes. there's an offset, something that's very important here. And the exact opposite, when you're reversing speech to find out what a person may actually mean when you don't trust what they're saying in their forward speech, the subconscious is correcting that, but it does it in imagery, mainly metaphor. And these metaphors are all the same for every culture, every age, which is very interesting. So it's better than a polygraph, because not only do you find out that they're lying, but you find out what the truth is at the same time. Of course, it's in metaphor. For instance, if Bill Clinton's talking about his wife in reverse speech, he's talking about the woman with the spear. So make of that what you will, but I see it as having a particular meaning. Others may not share. However, it's an interesting reversal all the same. With the split consciousness, which is not a natural evolutionary evolved trait, there are specific problems. But one of the things that I found out, and that E.T. is beginning to agree with me about, is that the compensations, the changes, sometimes convolutions, which eventually become something else, have created something spectacular, something that's capable of a more advanced art form, of very colorful expressions in genre, elegant fiction, elegant art, elegant music. Everything seems to be carried to a higher degree of expression, which E.T. is becoming increasingly aware of. So if this salvageable, this may be something new. After all, the universe hates redundance. I say that, and I mean it, on the basis of what I've known. And we're going through patterns to satisfy some maybe remote but inherent intellect that's so vast, that's so predominant, that's so ordered, that's so orderly, that wants every option expressed.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I am an artist myself, and I learned the hard way that sometimes the neatest things that you come up with were your mistakes. Yeah, it's true. You know, a technique or something, it was a total mistake, but you never would have thought to do it.
Well, this planet is an excellent example of that.
Yeah, I think it would be great if we could get over all of this and add a new level of creative intensity to the universe. I think that would be fun.
Well, as I explained one time, these people are all that bad. How come there's so many examples of beauty and creativity that excel anything you know? And that was a winning argument.
All right. Well, chalk one up for Team Earth.
Well, you have a lot of friends. And, you know, these examples that are probably the number around 150, where UFOs have come over, munition dumps that housed extremely deadly weapons, not just nuclears. But where they've come over and they've disarmed them, or they've changed the way in which they can be triggered. In some cases, they've rendered them harmless. that will not be going on if what I'm saying is not true. But it was done to the Russians first, or the Soviets. It was done to them because they were building in that remote Siberian test site that people talk about. They were building something that was a worse doomsday device than what we have.
James, there was something that you mentioned in the first presentation that we did regarding the moon. We were talking about how our ancestors had engineered the moon as a vessel to bring a large segment of our ancestors' population here. And then you mentioned there was something similar going on in the asteroid belt right now. So I have two questions about that. The first question is, the way you described what was going on in the asteroid belt now, as though it was as though mass was being collected, which is a little bit different than the way I was looking at it. I was thinking, well, maybe they find a planetoid of sorts and then hollow it out, but that may not be the case. So how is that normally done? And then also I would like to know who's doing it.
The extended community, ETs are doing it. They are gathering the debris in the asteroid belt and consolidating it. If it compacts and holds, they'll make something more out of it. But for right now, it's a matter of debris control for the solar system.
Oh, I see. So this is not a method for creating another vehicle for travel. This is just more about engineering in the system in a different way.
Not a vehicle, but possibly a moon, depending on how much material there is and how well it consolidates. It could be used for something more substantial, but it's just a matter of when this is done, what it conforms best to.
Okay, and then when we talked about our ancestors coming here on the moon, how many of our ancestors were actually in the moon?
At the time that it came into this system, between 250,000 and 300,000.
That's a lot of people.
That's a lot of people.
Yeah, so, well, let me ask this. Is the moon the only vehicle they used to come here?
No, there were other craft, but they weren't transport craft. They were scout craft, and they had been used to lay out the navigational pattern. The structures that exist now in the solar system weren't as dependable and as reliable like the solar anvil, and all this was perfected later on.
We know that there are other anomalies in our solar systems in terms of other moons that may not be natural. Is that tied to our ancestors coming here as well?
Well, not so much. It's similar. It's not directly related. There are people here from all over that have come and gone. These questions are difficult to answer because they prescribe to linear time and to the concept of chronology that is built into most people's concept or precepts. And this doesn't have that kind of progress.
Okay. You've mentioned before that the other planets in our system are inhabited. So kind of along those same lines, how many of those inhabitants are also from our ancestral stock, I guess we could say?
There are bases throughout the solar system of your ancestors, or people that came from the same source, but there's only one colony, and that's on Venus. But there are representative bases. These people belong to the extended community. They are actually more like ET than you, and they look down. They're your chief detractors, as a matter of fact. They're the least forgiving because that's just the way people are. They don't want to be reminded of their past and of their mistakes, and most ETs of a very truly advanced civilization don't either. And that's just the way that people are everywhere.
Well, now how did that work? So we have some of the people that came over on the moon are currently on Venus, is what you're saying.
Yes. Well, the descendants of them, they are people that decided on a different way. That always happens. That's how a universe gets populated with people because, you know, it doesn't matter. When you get to a level where you have star travel and the ability to do the kinds of things that your ancestors could do, nobody makes up their mind to do the same thing. it calls for something as momentous as this. And so some people go along, some people decide they want to do something different. Some people just bail out completely, but don't want to leave like the blondes. And then they, over a period of time, reestablish elsewhere, but maintain a base here.
Yeah, I can see that, because you have so many more choices when you get out there.
That's right. And you find people that you are more agreeable with in other places, and you like them, and you build bonds and connections. And so, you know, if there happens to be a friendly environment nearby, you might set up just on the basis of how agreeable you find them. That happens. It happens over and over again. When time is not your limiter, in other words, when you look vastly beyond the next decade, the next generation, the next age, you keep in perspective the trends that you lose here because of political changes. You know, when anything happens in the political arena among people that have an elite, things get covered up, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have a true idea of your lineage or even what's happened from one generation to the next, because it's being rewritten for the edification of the controllers.
That's exactly right. Deleted and rewritten at the same time. And I think that's really important to know, because we were such once great people, and so much effort has been put into robbing us of that identity to the degree that we are being systematically taught that somebody else has to do things for us because we're not intelligent enough, which is really sad. I think it's really fascinating that there are some of our ancestors living on Venus. So if we get a view from a satellite in space of a craft, it may actually be one of our own ancestors.
That's right. That's right. And they look like you. They may have a different attitude by far, and they may seem superior in their attitude and that sort of thing. But essentially, the only difference is they have a unified consciousness, and they consider you less because you have a divided consciousness. But then that's even changing today. And people are beginning to see that both sides of this coin have their own arguable differences and distinctions for benefits.
So I would imagine that because they have not gone through what we went through, because they took a different path, that Venus had helium.
Venus has helium. Now, I know there are people out there that are experimenting trying to breathe helium to the exclusion of other gases. You have to understand that an atmosphere on any planet never has just one gas. You have combination, and so you would have to be really prepped, and you would have to develop certain modifications over time, which can happen to one individual in order to be able to breathe just solely helium. But that's not entirely desirable anyway, because you would be that much harder pressed to take off your helmet, for instance, on Mars and breathe air on Mars. If you came from an environment that was radically different, there would be a respiratory shock. But if you are associating your respirant with a number of varied gases, then your ability to more immediately adapt to a new environment, say you like to tour, you like to visit, or whatever. Somebody that was a purist and said, well, I'm just going to use helium, I'm going to acquire the ability to breathe just helium, that's not advisable at all. That's silly. People that are in very limited spaces where efficiency is very important will seal their environment, because helium escapes the slightest leak that it can find. And they don't want to have to buffer their respirant. They are people that would prefer to have a higher concentration of helium, but still they're going to want some of the other respirant gases because they don't want to go into a respirant shock when they come home or they go somewhere else. So you keep your options open as much as possible when you're a member of a community that travels from planet to planet or star system to star system.
That makes a lot of sense when you explain it. And of course, we would know that if we were part of that community. So I think that's neat for you to point that out, because we don't think like that, because we aren't out there.
No.
So it's very, very helpful. Now, when our ancestors came here and we had groups kind of go their separate ways, this particular group on Venus, did they have to also engineer Venus to hold helium, or was it already...
There were already people there. Of course, at that point, due to a caste system developing on Mars and Earth, these people that reestablished themselves, they remind me very much of what was going on in colonial times or post-colonial times with respect to America, where there were people like Aaron Burr that did not like the way things were going after the first Constitutional Convention and wanted to reestablish another country out west. Well, the same kind of thing happened when these people went to Venus. They found that there was a lot more intelligent life in the solar system than they had thought, but they didn't want to inform those that were still on Mars and Earth because they could see the problems that were developing. They wanted no part of it.
Mm-hmm. I can understand that. I think that was a good choice.
Yes.
So, how many other planets in our system are inhabited by what we may refer to as our ancestors?
Just Venus. They have bases elsewhere. All of the planets in our system have intelligent life on them in one form or another.
I see. Okay. So when our ancestors came here, there were already people on Venus.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
And were there people on other planets besides Venus and Mars also?
Yes. Yes. Earth even had people. They were, since Earth was in the stage it was in and was going through a lot of vulcanization, the people there were Stone Age. There were two different species. There were Neanderthals and Cro-Magnons, and they were not living well together.
And how was that working if they were developing in an environment that did not hold helium?
Well, it didn't bother them. Of course, their lifespans were pretty short because of what they had to do to provide for their young and the warfare, the raiding that was going on. They were savage. Cro-Magnon wasn't, I wouldn't call them savage, but they had to fight for their lives against Neanderthal, who would raid them for whatever they could take and wanted their women.
Were these two groups transplants as well, or did they develop here on this planet in the beginning?
They're all transplants. I firmly believe, because I've never seen anything to contradict it, I firmly believe that sentience is exceedingly rare and comes from one place.
Now, you've mentioned that before.
It gets thrown around, and, you know, somewhere out there somebody can use a radio wave to affect DNA. I don't look at that as a separate evolution or bilateral evolution. Where sentience is concerned, I don't believe in bilateral evolution.
So what you're saying is that there's a source out there somewhere that seeds sentience.
Yes, yes. And sometimes you can see that, you know, you go find a civilization that for some reason or another, not necessarily good reason, does this rather irresponsibly. And for other reasons, you begin to see so many similarities, and even cold-blooded people and warm-blooded. The differences are insignificant. The differences are only matter when you have a prescribed idea of beauty or a prescribed idea of politics or how someone survives in an atmosphere, whatever. The modifications are traits that come about that are imposed out of necessity by an environment different than another are minimal, and they're not really observable that much in the appearance.
That makes a lot of sense, and of course we still have our own problems here with our own race, don't we? If they're a different color, well, they must be different, but really on the inside we're all the same, especially if we're sentient, right?
Absolutely. Here on Earth, you obviously all come from one source. I mean, you know, physiologists don't challenge that today at all, but at one time they did. At one time, there were established ethnologists and anthropologists who believed in bilateral evolution, and that's just absurd. I mean, if you stop and think about it, the only people that would even want to believe that kind of a thing are racists who are trying to build a case for one race being superior to another.
Mm-hmm. And they've done a fine job.
they've divided a lot of good people and confused issues all along. We're finding out today that, you know, if you want a minimal amount of intelligence or what the golden mean is, whatever, it's pretty much the same from race to race. And some people have adaptive abilities over others. But, you know, the difference is as far as intellect go or cultural, they're not physiological.
Right. And that's something I think that a lot of us are really trying to get across, because one of the ways that we are controlled is divide and conquer. And that's a problem. We need to really begin to see past that, because we are all living on the same planet. We all have the same desires and wants. We want to be healthy. We want to be happy. We want our children to be healthy and happy. We're not really that different from each other, and we should stop letting people tell us that we are.
That's right. And again, this carries over to the fear that people have of what may lie outside their system.
Yes, it gets projected outward.
Yeah, it gets projected. And that's what you can see now as people are being misled more and more. You can see that as an agenda behind the controllers who want to continue practicing this divide and conquer agenda right on out to the stars if they really think they'll ever get out there, which they won't, thank God.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that we as a people won't if we overcome them and put them in their place, put them where they belong, right there with us, no better, no worse, but put them in their place. Everybody's place should be the same. Doesn't mean that they won't have the same victories in life, the same edification for accomplishment and so forth. Those are the things that matter, not how big your townhouse is. I'd much rather raise the standard of living of everybody and live in a world free of guilt and free of having to watch people go hungry and then having somebody mandate a law against feeding them, which, you know, is current. People wake up. We are either going to prove to our neighbors out there that we are fit to be a part of something more and have friends that can help us in ways we can't imagine now.
And we need that help desperately, I think, if you look at Fukushima and the Gulf of Mexico, because the people on our planet certainly are not going to fix it. And those of us that want to don't have the technology refined enough to know if we can fix it fast enough.
Well, let's look at something that's even worse than all that. We know that there is a grab for water. We also know about fracking. Has anyone put together that fracking is a way of destroying the value of the water you don't own in order to enhance the value of the water you do own?
Yes, I actually thought about that when you were explaining what we did to the crust of Mars and how that also interfered with their atmosphere. It reminds me of a very similar situation.
Well, what happened on Mars is going on here, only it's more incremental here. But if it wasn't for the EMVs in Utah and that operation near the La Salle Mountains, then there would have been so many major changes to the crust, so much crustal movement, that there wouldn't be any cities. There probably wouldn't be the continued government or whatever, which may not be a bad thing in the long run. But there would have already been such tribulation and loss of life that I doubt very strongly civilization would have continued very long under the kind of leadership, the brittle, just totally tyrannical leadership that you have. Because they have to have certain things in their program that are stable and controllable in order to persist. And they don't understand their own structure well enough to know that. The changes that they want to impose on this planet will be their end, regardless of whether the masses of people wake up and do something about it.
That is exactly right. And I think that's important, because when we do these kinds of shows, we are not just educating what people refer to as the 99%. The people that are doing all of this themselves do not understand their own planet and their own system well enough to have the kind of control they really think they have over it. And there was something that you and I had talked about once, and I would like you to explain this, because I think this is another one of those things that they don't know. They're messing with things they don't understand. You had once mentioned that there is some kind of an organism in our atmosphere. At the time, we were talking about chemtrails and how that may actually be killing these organisms. Can you explain to people what these organisms are and what they do?
Well, let me make an illustration first. You remember back a few years ago about people that were discovering the tubes. And some of these tubes weren't moving just constantly. Some of these tubes were giving them an opportunity to photograph them, and they could see compartments inside them like a ship. And some of them were vast, and they were around the planet, but they weren't visible to the normal spectrum most people employ for eyesight. But they were getting these graphics and seeing that these were compartmentalized, that they had very elaborate designs on the inside, geometric designs and so forth. And these people weren't just dreaming this up. This wasn't a fantasy. So imagine if it can exist in size. Imagine what can subsist at the same level that's microscopic, or let's say just slightly above microscopic in size. Throughout the atmosphere, throughout space, throughout almost everywhere, that there is a niche for some living thing to be. And this, of course, goes on in our atmosphere. Now, the chemtrails have killed off certain microbes that are in the atmosphere, which absorb energy and flourish and build their own colonies and add to the process of producing atmosphere and return to the atmosphere, just like the EMVs return energy to the sun and keep a more or less stable relationship between the energy exchange and the energy transfer. Well, these little critters do the same thing, and we had an inordinate number of chemtrails throughout the world year before last. And so the summer of last year, we had a white light, a full spectrum light that was killing shrubs, trees, bushes. Even though you'd water them, fertilize them, try to take care of them, and just flat out killing them. And it happened here, it happened all over, because we didn't have the filtration that we'd normally have if these microbes living in our atmosphere hadn't been reduced in numbers so much that they couldn't add to the quality of our environment the way they had.
That's really important, because I don't really think they know this. There are a lot of things that they don't know. They're messing with things that they don't understand to their own end, because if the planet goes, they go too. And it's really frustrating, because they just...
Well, Crystal, you have good scientists, but a lot of good scientists aren't working as scientists anymore. Or if they are, they're having to keep their mouth shut and bite the bullet in order to keep their job. You know, when you don't show the enthusiasm for buying on to global warming and for adding to the war machine and for selling vaccines that are harmful and all this other crap, then you're suspected. So you're given a little slot. You're given less and less information to work with and paid less and doing lab work that when you could be in there working on theory and working on cosmology, working on things that you'd be a lot more of a value with. But they're not interested in value. They're interested in adding to their control. Not discovery, but keeping people that have made discoveries, even under these constraints, keeping them from getting their discoveries to the public. It's minimalization. It's a good word. And what it means is the control of information to suit an agenda and to put anybody that's a threat in a position to demasculate them intellectually or professionally so that they can't be another Dr. Norman Berggren, for instance.
Yes, but the reason that it's so important that the information does get out is because that whole agenda thing, regardless of which side you're on, if you're the guy that won't say anything because you don't want your grants pulled, or if you're the guy threatening the guy not to say anything, both of those actions or inactions go to the same place, extinction.
They really certainly do.
And they need to understand that. It won't work either way. So that's really frustrating. And so I thank you for giving that example, because I don't really think people know that, at least in any meaningful way, because why would you hide it if you know that if you kill these critters off, your planet's going to cook? You know, you're not going to survive that.
Crystal, the reason that I can say this, I don't feel any need to qualify it, is that you take the Gulf of Mexico. Everybody knows what coral is and can see it. They know that it's delicate. They know that it does a number of things for saltwater environment. In fact, it keeps the salt environment healthy. It's a necessary part. And they know that if they know anything at all about it in particular, they know that Corexit took that oil right down on that coral and that will kill the coral. Therefore, they know when their president comes out and say, oh, pretty soon it's going to be better than ever, that he is either the most ignorant hound to ever have a forum of that type, or he is a damn liar. Either way, the result is significant equally, that we have people that are pulling strings, running things, making decisions of authority that make no sense in the perspective of right, wrong, or indifferent to the consequences of what's being done to the world. The same is true of the political leaders in Japan who sit there impotently, just as Barack Obama sat there impotently when the Gulf of Mexico disaster occurred, and fold their hands up and let companies that have professed no value for the environment of Japan come in and make decisions. That's exactly what happened in the Gulf of Mexico. BP absolutely had no interest in the impact on our environment in the Gulf of Mexico than the people that ran those nuclear reactors at Fukushima. When you realize that, when you really get that down and you see the full ramifications of it, you have got a blueprint for what's going on all over the world by these industrial magnates who have reached the point of just absolute irresponsibility.
Mm-hmm. It sounded like you were going to say lunacy, and I think that's a good
it
term.
Is. Oh, we're being nice, Crystal.
We are. Nice. That is the truth. We are being very nice.
They're suicidal to the point of homicide.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
I think it's something to do with maybe the god they worship or whatever. You know, we talked about that. We know that they bond together around Lucifer. It's like Fulford recently said when he introduced in his last release these two gentlemen that were interesting. He said that, yeah, we know they worship Satan. Well, it's essentially the same thing. It's something that will absorb. It's a figurehead, a god, or whatever you want that'll absorb all the guilt for your inhuman practices.
I think another thing that people are going to, in their own mind's eye, say to themselves as well, the reason that they are willingly letting this planet die is because they can go somewhere else to another planet and hide, and that is not the case. We did talk about Mars a little bit, but I really want to dig into that because all of the conspiracy theorists are pushing that idea that they can go to the moon and hide, or they can go to Mars and hide. So let's talk about Mars first. Are they still even allowed on Mars now?
No.
And why not? Why were they asked to leave?
They were weaponizing space.
Okay, and how were they asked to leave Mars?
Well, they were warned, and when that didn't do it, then the ETs that are there started terraforming with a little guy that devours their metal.
Now, I want people to understand that. They didn't shoot laser beams and kill anybody. They were very, very gracious, but they meant what they said, and that was their
That's
way of
right.
dealing with it. It doesn't harm humans.
No. In fact, it gives you time. When you start seeing this fungus on your Land Rover or whatever, that you've got enough time to figure out that you better get out of there before it starts affecting your lander or whatever you're using, and it won't affect EB craft. But, you know, they can only do so much with EB craft. That's what they use, basically. But what they build, they have to use a metal that does not have any way of resisting being devoured by this little guy. And they don't know how to deal with that. Here's the thing. They better not even try, because having proven themselves to be an unfit neighbor, if they figured out a way to get rid of the little guy, then the next stage would go on. Mm-hmm. They better not, you know, it's like with anything else. If you're next to somebody that's got maybe 100,000 years of technology ahead of you, don't think a countermeasure. Don't think
that
about...
That is so true, and people don't get that. Oh, the ETs are going to invade us. and take everything we have. Well, look, if they want to see humanity go down, at this point, all they have to do is stand and watch. We're doing it to ourselves.
That's right.
And if they really wanted what we had, they could take it. They don't.
They damn sure take it before you despoiled it the way you have.
Now, this happened on Mars, this mold. What about the moon?
Same thing.
Same thing. Okay. So how long ago was this that we were kicked out because we were the same idiotic mentality of weaponizing and destroying everything? We were already beginning to project.
Pretty early. Pretty early. I know that it was decided. I can tell you when E.T. decided that you had to go. And that was about the same time that you started trying to expand your underground tunnels and everything. Just before 1978. And if you'll notice, all of a sudden, people started hearing these strange noises around their cities and so forth because they were building these underground cities, thinking that that would be a substitute for when they started letting the worst come to worse here. Of course, they had yet to realize that no matter where they do or what they do, they have to buff their air, don't they? They have to buffer their air. I'm going to say this for the sake of the facilitators. I've never said it before. You got to buffer your air, right? So you have to have openings to your underground installation so you can buffer your air, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
You're not safe no matter how deep or how you dig your holes to hide in or whatever. You're not safe. Give it up. Facilitators, figure it out. You're on the wrong side.
Exactly. You are on the wrong side. That's very, very true. Now, here's another thing that I think is so important about getting this story out, because humanity has been baffled with their BS for a very long time, and it's escalating in terms of how advanced they supposedly are with their own space weapons and spaceships. So let's talk about that really quick, because when I discovered that the equations weren't right, that they were giving out for getting to the moon in rockets, and after having looked at it and really thought about it, there's no way they could have went to the moon in what they told us they did. But I do think that they went. So how did they really get there?
AB craft.
I mean, it makes sense to me.
Yeah. Well, they were in a race with the Soviets, and the Soviets were showing them up, so they had, there was another country that was at loggerheads with the Soviets that had a technology that was so vastly ahead of ours, a little third world nation, and so we bought theirs. So
that
we could put on it. Yeah, so
yeah.
We could put on an act.
Exactly.
And show that we could catch up with them and so forth, because this was a store dressing. Meanwhile, there is no real competition between the Soviet Union and the United States. They're both complicit in building bases and getting ready to establish colonies on both Mars and the moon. And like I said, a lot of the structure that you see up there is deserted now because they started weaponizing space.
And that's not good. And I think this also answers the really perplexing question. If we really did go to the moon, why did they fake the moon landing footage? Well, if they actually went there in an EB craft, they would have to, because they wouldn't
want
to know how they got there.
Oh, that's right, Crystal. So they had to have the Roman candle scenario. And so that had to be staged because it didn't want to really show the conditions on the moon. The moon has areas where you can breathe. It just depends on what's in place. There's vegetation there. There's vast, I wouldn't call them cities, but I would say that they're large towns. And there are all sorts of structures because it's been mined over the years by all kinds of guys from all over the place. You cannot challenge the substructure, but you can do anything else you want on the moon. Just don't weaponize anything, don't challenge the substructure, and stay out of where the machines are. Is that too much to ask? And you can take all of the resources that you want. It's an interesting understanding with people that come through, with people that are in the extended community. People have no idea about what governs the conduct of interstellar communities, interstellar people, and travelers.
Mutual respect.
It's, can we help you?
Do you need any help? If you do, just let us know. That's the attitude. We all look at each other as fellow travelers.
I can see that, and I would love to really see it for real. It would be great. And I know that we're trying to keep this one kind of short, and we've covered a great deal of information in this series. So is there anything that you would like to cover before we end it?
I would just like to tell everyone that there are wonderful things to discover, and the discovery doesn't lead down a dark forest path with a wolf at the end of it. It's eye-opening and a wonderful journey. So you're being held down, and overcome those that are holding you down as peacefully as you can and move to the next level.
Hear, hear. Yeah. It's time. We're at that place where we really have to decide which way do we want to go, because the window won't stay open forever. People need to really think about what kind of a future do they want. Do they want this horrific slave transhumanism, depopulated, destroy everything in the process? Or do they want what we once had? Which sounds really pretty awesome. So thank you very much, James, for doing this series. I really appreciate it. And thank you again to Helvetic, the creator of information-machine.blogspot.com, for asking us to do this show.
Thank you, Crystal.
Good night.